is time to strike up the California Marching Band. For the first time in 4 weeks, the Bears are back on the field at Memorial Stadium. It is a gorgeous first Saturday of fall in Berkeley, and the Bears are recharged off their bye week and set to take on the Colorado State Rams from the Mountain West Conference. Good afternoon and welcome to Cal Bear College Football here on Comcast Sportsnet alongside the former Hall of Famer here at Cal, Mike Pawlowski. I'm Greg Papa. The Bears are not happy with the way they played 2 weeks ago. They're going to try to be more physical today.
That's right. Coach Bob Gregory, defensive coordinator, told us his defense came out and looked soft versus Maryland. They do not want to be soft. They're going to take it to Colorado State today and try to be physical.
He said soft, Coach, not me.
Right.
Coach Gregory said that. So how do they beat the Colorado State Rams today, Mike?
Well, offensively, the Bears have to be effective with their vertical passing game. They have to throw the ball down the field to spread the field out. They haven't been hitting those. They've been in second and third and long and haven't been successful converting. They also have to run the ball inside. Once you get that vertical passing game going, it'll be 7 men in the box. You run the ball inside and pound it at Colorado State. On defense, they have to rush the passer. Billy Ferris is young and experienced, but he's a fifth-year senior, and this guy has the tools to throw it down the field if you give him time. He's a good quarterback, and if you don't get after him, he will hurt you through the air.
Colorado State Rams, like the Bears, come in with a record of 2-1. They lost their opener to CU. They have since beaten Sacramento State and last week beat the University of Houston Cougars 28-25. The Bears will receive the opening kickoff. This is Ben DeLine, a true freshman kicker from Steamboat Springs, Colorado, who will kick off. And you know the Roadrunner, Javid the Jet. Javid Best is back after taking that hellacious hit 2 weekends ago at the home of the Maryland Terrapins in College Park. He is back. Bears are 2-1, trying to rebound from that tough 35-27 defeat at the University of Maryland. Could it be any more beautiful?
Oh, it's an absolutely perfect day here in Strawberry Canyon. What a great place to play a football game in the fall with this kind of Bay Area weather.
Bears have not been here since Labor Day weekend, where they beat Michigan State. Best will start from the 5. Across the 20, 30, 40. Still going. He's going to try to reverse his field, and he's in Colorado State territory. He is electrifying.
Those big guys are going to have a hard time tackling him on that kickoff return. There's a reason this guy is number 2 in the country at all-purpose yards, averaging 234.7 all-purpose yards. Great job blocking by that kickoff return team for Cal. And you see Javid right here just making people miss and trying to use that speed to the inside. Barely got tripped up, or that one could have been to the house.
An explosive play right away. Best on the opening kickoff goes 45 yards with the return. You like this Bear look? They're going blue on blue today as they start on the Ram 49-yard line. Best is motioned out to the left. Tofo'o is the only back. It's an end around. It's a reverse, and they pitch it. And this is going to barely get back to the original line of scrimmage. And as the Bears try a little gadget play there, Jeremy Ross was the receiver, the wide receiver, Mike, who came around to the true reverse. They gave it to Best and came back to Ross on the reverse, and it lost a yard.
We saw the look on Ross with the reverse 2 weeks ago, trying to mix it up, trying to give Colorado State something to think about early on. Frank Cignetti, offensive coordinator, goes into his playbook.
What a game he had last game out 2 weekends ago at College Park, although a lot of that came late in the game. He had a 33 of 58 day for 423 yards passing. Second down at 11. Here's Best up the middle, and he'll pick up about 4 as we take a look at the Cal Bear offense led by quarterback Kevin Riley. Of course, Javid Best will run a lot, but we'll see Shane Vereen as well. Tofo'u, the great lead blocker. They have realigned everybody on the offensive line. Schwartz winds up at left tackle today. Teofoli moves to right tackle. They have flipped spots. We have Guarnero in the starting lineup, but he is not starting at left guard. That is the sophomore, Mark Boscovich, who makes the start. So Roddy goes into the shotgun here on third down. Pressure. He's got Best, but he'll be tackled shy of the first down. So we'll see what Coach Tedford does here on a fourth down and short coming up.
And one of the complaints Jeff Tedford had for us yesterday when we talked to him was they weren't very good in their third down conversions, leaving themselves with a lot of second and third and long situations. They were only 2 of 11, and they're only 30% in third down conversions on the year. So one of the things they need to think about is getting some positive yards in first and second down situation to leave them with third and short.
Here's the kick coming up by Brian Anger. He has had a good year kicking it this early year for the freshman. And it'll go in the end zone for a touchback. Kim McNicholas is on the sidelines today. Hey, Kim, how are you?
Yeah, you were mentioning that that Colorado State's quarterback, Billy Fair, is definitely experienced, but he is concerned about Cal's defense. He says that fourth linebacker could definitely make it difficult to connect on some of passes. But he said he's watched quite a bit of videotape of Cal, and he says he's prepared as he can be for Cal's blitzing strategies. He says the best he can do is, quote, watch my percentage and keep my eyes wide open. But you know what? He has not thrown an interception since September 6th, so something we'll be watching out there, guys.
Getting used to a new system from a 3-4 to a, from a 4-3 to a 4-3-4 this year for Cal. You just have to account for bodies and figure out who they are.
There's the counter handoff to Gartrell Johnson. Nice open field tackle by Darian Hagan. One thing they were working on during their bye week is making sure he forces the run, and they were able to make the nice tackle there on the first run of the game by Johnson. Johnson will run a lot. He's 227 pounds. We'll also see Kyle Bell, who ran for over 100 yards last year against the Bears. Here's the offensive line. Tim Walter is the center. He's playing very well this year. He's very smart. And against this 3-4 defense, the first time all year the Rams are seeing it, he has to make sure everybody gets blocked up. Second down and eight coming up for the Rams out of the shotgun. This play is whistled on before it starts on a pre-snap penalty.
Rulon Davis over there pointing across the line, of course, of Adrian Martinez.
Dead ball, false start. Number 60 offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
So on the strong side guard, Adrian Martinez, the junior. Now that'll drop Colorado State into a second and long. Three-man front for the Bears, obviously, this year. Tyson Alulu is just playing like a beast, and they have all these great linebackers. That's why they've gone to the 3-4. Williams and Paulette are playing very well. In the secondary, Brett Johnson will start for Hicks. He is out with a thigh bruise. Here's Johnson hit behind the line. The Bears were not happy with the way they played defensively against Maryland. You used the four-letter word. Bob Gregory actually said it to us yesterday in a meeting. They were soft.
They were very physical
in their bye week.
This play, during the bye week, they were hitting each other live tackling. Live tackling during the season is unique for a team. But Coach Tedford and Coach Gregory thought we need to make sure we get our assignments, work through some of the technique stuff, the pad levels. And right there, Tyson Alulu showed how that paid off during the week. Alulu has just been the rock of that defensive line and continues to play well for the Bears.
They jump off sides here. Free play for Ferris on 3rd and 15. He's sacked by Rulon Jones, but the Cal Bears jumped off sides. I believe it was Cameron Jordan who came across. Or Rulon dead.
Had a couple guys on the left side of that line there.
Offside defense. 5-yard penalty. Replay third down.
Notice he didn't give a number. That's because there were a bunch of blue jerseys that were across the line before the snap.
There's Bob Gregory, the defensive coordinator here in Berkeley.
Rulon Davis, one of the offenders. Always easier to get in the backfield when you've got a half a step on the guy before the ball snap.
Cameron Jordan also jumped from his left defensive end spot. And now it's third down and 10. Yeah, they were in pads both Tuesday and Wednesday this week. They were supposed to be in shells for one of those days, but they did live hitting this week to get back to being physical. Bunch formation right for Ferris. Here's a blitz and a quick throw, and they heat him up right away. Mike Muhammad, the linebacker, came out of blitz, and the Bears will get the ball back quickly, forcing a three and out.
Well, exactly what the Bears needed to do. Rush the passer, get after Ferris. Don't let him get comfortable back in the pocket. Right now they are playing that physical style of D. And you can see oftentimes when coaches put you in pads, as you were pointing out, Greg, on days that you're not supposed to be in pads, it sends the message. We need to be tougher. We need to be more physical. We need to be disciplined about our assignments. And guys take that more to heart than any speech they could possibly give you.
Don't have to worry about Sitquan Thompson. What a great tackler he has turned out to be. Pressure up the middle. But Anthony Hartz, who is from Bishop O'Dowd High School, he blasts one here. And here's Sitquan with some room to go. And he gets about six back, made a nice over-the-shoulder catch. So that is a 57-yard punt by Anthony Hartz, who was back home. Grew up in the Bay Area, went to Bishop O'Dowd High School, and Sitquan Thompson takes it back 3 yards. So the Bears, Muhammad comes on a linebacker blitz, and they force the Rams three and out on their first possession. Jeff Tedford's Bears will start this possession on their 26-yard line. A little different look for coach. He does have the play call sheet, but not as big as before. And he's got the wristband, much like the quarterback. He gets the play calls from Their offensive coordinator has taken over the play calling duties here, Frank Cignetti Jr. While he throws, quick catch by Sean Jones. He is tackled after a short gain. Gotta be tough for Coach Tedford, huh?
To give up the play calling. Giving up the play calling duties, always tough. When you've been a guy that's controlled the offense and been in charge of creating space for your offense, setting up plays, you have a certain style. Tedford had that. Steve Fairchild actually told us yesterday he thought Jeff Tedford was one of the brightest minds in the offensive side of the game right now. But Coach Fairchild, pretty good mind on the offensive side of the ball himself, and he still calls his own plays.
And he's back to his alma mater, where he was a terrific quarterback, and he also served as the offensive coordinator for Sonny Lubick. Strange to see the Rams without Coach Lubick, who was there for 15 years. Little quick toss. That's a backwards pass and a live ball, and out of bounds. Sean Jones had to run it down, but the ball went directly out, so that'll be out where the ball went out of bounds. That was a backwards pass there by Riley, and a 3-yard loss, Mike.
And I think Tommy Hill right here may have gotten a hand on the ball, just batted a little bit, just enough to knock it off. And for a receiver, that is distracting in your view. Even if he doesn't touch it, having that big paw come across, you're waiting for that ball to change, and it throws off your equilibrium trying to look for that football in the air. So tough for Sean Young to make that catch, but a good job making sure you cover it and get it out of bounds.
So the Bears off to a bit of a sputtering start. Their first two possessions, despite the great kickoff return by Javid Best. Ricky Brewer, that weak side linebacker, number 56, someone to be concerned with here. And now a stoppage of play, delay a game on the Bears.
Dead ball, delay of game. Number 13 offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains third down.
A little rust after not playing last week. The Bears are a little sluggish on offense to open the game. And this is exactly what Coach Tedford, Mike, does not want to get into. You noted the third down inefficiency. They've converted just 30% on third downs this year, which is very poor.
That's a very poor mark for third down conversions. You want to be up around 45 to 50%, and that's a championship number.
This is third down and 14. Plenty of time for Riley. Short one to Javid Best. He can make up 14 in a split second if he gets the corner. Breaks the tackle, and he dives for the first down. He's got it. What a play.
A great individual play. There is no teaching speed. That's the one thing you can't coach. It's the one thing you can't create. Guys are either fast or they aren't, and Javid Best is fast. You're going to see him come out right in the middle here. Supposed to hit directly upfield. Instead, Javid turns it towards the sideline, and normally you tell a guy, don't take it east and west. Don't take it towards the sideline. Take it north and south down the field. But with wheels like Javid Best, you let him run sideline to sideline to see if he can create a crease.
He takes a play off. They go into an eye, and Shane Vereen is very capable. I don't even want to call him a backup, because he's pretty good. Tofoa, the lead block. Look at that lead block by Tofoa. And Vereen, that rolls out to around the 44-yard line. Of course, Javid Best has not played since two weekends ago when the Bears were at the University of Maryland in College Park. And I think you've seen this hit before. He got lit up there.
How about welcome to the East Coast? Ended up with a bruised sternum.
Very nice.
Yes. And that Gatorade was much better the first time, I'm sure. But afterwards, ended up getting some of the alligator arms. You know, you take a shot like that and you start thinking about where those helmets are coming from. Javid came back and made a great catch a few series later in that game. So got back into the game. But at first, you take that big shot, you don't want to take another one to the chest.
Now, ordinarily, we would say he lost his lunch on that. But yeah. The kickoff was at noon in Maryland, 9 o'clock Bay Area time. So he probably lost like his midnight snack from the night before.
Midnight snack or maybe a brunch.
Actually said this week it was blue Gatorade and a little Cytomax. Right. But that was a heck of a hit there by the defensive back who stepped up and just lit him up. That was Kevin Barnes of Maryland. But Javid came back into the game, and he had some good moments and bad, but was able to return. First and 10 from midfield. Here is Javid Best dancing in the hole. Fumbled the ball. The Rams should have had it. It's still free. Still free. Cameron Mora dived on it for Kale, but it may have slipped under his body here.
That ball was out there forever, wasn't it? They're just rolling around the turf.
Rams got it. Colorado State takes it. Mike Pagnotti, the safety, came up with the Javid Best fumble. Let's see where he lost it. As he broke into the second level, the ball just squirts out.
Nice job hitting the hole right here. Watch the strip off the right side. Boom. Oh, helmet right on the ball. That's tough to hold on to. The helmet directly on the tip of the football. You're supposed to have 5 points of pressure. Jobin had it tucked away pretty good, but that back point of pressure, the inside of the forearm wasn't there. Knocked that ball, squirted it directly out the backside.
Wade Landers, the senior defensive end, recovered it. Here's a draw up the middle, and they're out to midfield. Well, Jobin Best has had some big moments today. The 45-yard kickoff return, that terrific third down and 14 conversion. And then he gives it right back on the fumble.
And one thing that Jeff Tedford hates is turnovers. Drives him nuts. He says the most important stat in a football game is your turnover ratio. And any time the Bears put that ball on the ground, Coach Tedford just gets a scowl on his face. He gets an angry look.
Well, I don't know of any coach that likes turnovers, but he actually quantifies it. When the Bears win during a 7 years here, they win the turnover margin 28 times, 28-3 when they win the turnover margin. Here's Bell, who will also get a lot of carries for Gartrell Johnson. Kyle Bell is 234 pounds. You remember when the Bears were in Fort Collins a year ago, he rushed for over 100 yards, 102, Mike, on 26 carries and a couple of touchdowns. At that time, he was the lead back and Johnson was the fullback. And then at mid-year, they started to turn and hand the ball off to Gartrell Johnson, but both are bruisers.
Yeah, they're absolute bruisers. We talk about lightning and lightning on Cal's side. When you have Vereen and Best, you have thunder and thunder on the Colorado State side. Just two big guys pounding the ball up inside. And as you said, Kyle Bell was the feature back, but Gartrell Johnson really came on for this Rams offense.
Third down and less than a yard. Here's Bell, hit behind the line. Let's see where they spot it. I think he should be spotted shy of the required 45-yard line. He was not able to turn his body, and they are going to properly spot this. They're going to be short by a half a yard. We'll see what Coach Fairchild does here.
And watch this deep inside. The quickest way to stop a running back, get a hold of that football right there. Reach it inside. Like he says, Darian Hagan, reaching and pulling that ball back. You can try to take the big guy on head on, but he's going to run over you. You hold on to that football, and you're going to stop him in a hurry.
They're going to go for it here on the Bears, 45 and a half. They need a foot or two. Quarterback has good size, Billy Ferris, at 6'3", 2 1/4". He may just sneak it here. They go into an eye. Now they're going to turn and give it to Bell, and he dives for the first down. Well, Bell down to the Bears' 44-yard line, first and 10 for Colorado State.
You're running those big bruising backs and the I formation, you have to figure out with big guys like that, they have to be able to get a foot at least advancing the ball forward, especially when you're in the middle of the field and you have to honor play action pass. You know, so many times teams get geared up for that fourth down conversion and you forget about receivers downfield. Sometimes coaches will pop you with the play action pass on the fourth and short.
Now, Bell had those numbers in the game last year in Fort Collins against Cal alone. Ferris going deep ball down the sideline, but he throws the ball out of bounds. That's Ryan Gardner, who was born in San Francisco, went to Rodriguez High School from Fairfield, California, and also Diablo Valley College. He's got some tremendous speed down the field. Of course, last week at the University of Houston, you figured it would be a shootout, and they did win that game by a score of a 28-25 and a couple of lengthy drives to win that game. Colorado State out of the Mountain West Conference, and I think you're all aware the Pac-10 has not beaten the Mountain West this year. They've lost all five matchups with them. Second and 10. Pocket holds for Ferris. That's dropped by Morton. He wasn't going to go very far anyway, Mike, as Hagan had him in his sights, but that's a drop there by Morton.
Yeah, he's got to try to reach back and catch that ball with his hands. Instead, he reached back and tried to cradle that ball in. Morton, both of the receivers actually on this Colorado State football team, we talked to head coach Steve Fairchild yesterday and said that these guys were absolutely awful in the spring, but they've really come on this year.
Here are the defeats. In the one day, they lost four times. What was that BYU-UCLA score?
And that one was ugly.
59-0.
Ugly.
Wow. Third down and 10. Colorado State Rams play a lot of the same offense that the old St. Louis Rams play with Mike Marsh. Multiple wide receivers. That ball was batted down by Rulon at Davis. So the Bears will get the ball back here. They'll force a punt. His passing game not clicking at all as Billy Ferris has missed on his first four attempts. Good push there by the Bears front line.
And that's the key, Greg. These guys are getting upfield, playing some games inside. You have Alu and Rulon Davis both coming upfield, mixing it up, a little twist inside by your strong tackle and your defensive end, mixing it up, twist, throw something different at them, give them a look that they're not used to.
Blocked, Anthony Hart's had it blocked. It's a free ball, and this will be a Cal touchdown. Scooped up and run in by Nabufi, that's his second blocked punt return for a score this year. He had one against Michigan State in the opener, and he's got another one here.
How about that? Two blocked punt returns on the year for one guy. That's a very unique stat.
In
27 yards for the touchdown.
Bryant Nabufi, he picked up the blocked punt that Brett Johnson had on opening night here against Michigan State, and he got the fortuitous block there right off the field turf. He scooped it up and returns it 27 yards. That punt was blocked backwards a long way.
That was a gimme. That was almost better than a Jason Kitt bounce pass right there. Just bounce right up in your arms and keep running with it.
It'll have the correct personnel on. The point after, David Seawright is set. His true freshman is off to a good start. He's hit all 17 of his point afters and four of his first five field goals. So the Bears a bit sluggish on offense. So how do you get a score? You block a punt. Nabufi will scoop it up again and roll 27 yards for a touchdown. Let's see where they got it. Right up the middle. The pressure comes there. And there's the block. It may have been Devin Bishop who blocked that punt. We'll check that when we come back.
Taking advantage on special teams for their first score of the day. Jeff Perinick right here, starting middle linebacker, trying to step in the gap. Linebacker Kendricks, reserve linebacker for Cal, comes in and just blows him up, blows him back into the kicker. And it's a gimme for Nabufi as he runs for the end zone. And as you said, Greg, if you're not getting it done on offense, why not score on special teams? Have them pick you up.
Michael Kendricks, the true freshman from Hoover High School in Fresno. That's a big play. The Bears really needed that kind of pick me up there. Mosier on the kickoff return for Colorado State. Now we saw him up at the Palouse. Look at Zach Follett come in and they get a block field goal here. Look at Follett just picks it up and he runs it back the other way. And 68 yards and a block field goal. This is their second punt block touchdown of the year, Mike. And this is all in the first four games of the year.
Yeah, they've had some very good special teams play. Pete Alomar, special teams coordinator for Cal, must be very happy with his units right now.
They've already got three touchdowns. That's not bad at all. And the Rams will start on their 28-yard line. Morton goes in motion for Colorado State. This back is very tough. Johnson hits the second level, keeps his leg churning, and he's all the way out to the 45-yard line. A 16-yard run there by Gartrell Johnson.
One of the things Steve Fairchild, as an NFL coach, former NFL coordinator, he likes that zone play. You're going to see flow of a line coming this way. Running back has to read. You read as you follow that zone blocking. As soon as you get a gap, you squirt through it. And that time, Colorado State did a nice job of blocking not just the first level, but the second level and getting him some extra yards.
You mentioned his association with Mike Martz. He was the offensive coordinator for Coach Martz. So when Mike became the head coach of the St. Louis Rams, setting up a screen, pressure up the middle and intercepted. And this may be a touchdown the other way. The Bears have their second touchdown. This is Brett Johnson. A safety who makes his first start today, a 44-yarder thrown directly to him. So they got one on teams, they've got one on defense now.
Not a bad way to kick off your starting career. Get your first start at home, get an interception for a touchdown. Bears firing on defense right now. We talked about it as one of the keys to the game. In the open, they have to get after the passer, Billy Ferris. Right now, he's as uncomfortable as could be in the pocket. That time, he took a shot as he tried to deliver the ball, and Brett Johnson saw Christmas come early in Strawberry Canyon.
And they lift him high above here. That's two touchdowns for the Bears in 48 seconds. One on the blocked punt, Nabufi, and now Johnson on the interception goes back 44 yards. Seawright right down the middle again, and the Bears have a 14-0 lead. Brett Johnson makes the start for Bernard Hicks, who was out with a thigh bruise. Pressure, ball tipped. And that's an easy 44-yard roll to a two-score lead. Temperature in the high 70s here in Berkeley. They're used to this. The Bears have won 23 of their last 27 at home, Mike. A lot of pressure here on a first and 10.
Keith Browner bringing the heat, getting upfield. Warrell Williams coming in, clearing a hole, hitting the quarterback right in the chest. Browner gets the tip. And that's just a gimme for Brett Johnson to walk into the end zone. Nobody in front of you. Right now, Billy Ferris, quarterback for Colorado State, is feeling the heat back there in the pocket.
He's not completed the pass. He's 0 for 5. Well, he has completed the pass here to Brett Johnson.
You want to hit your same color jersey, generally speaking, when you're completing balls.
That's Mike Myers, and he gets run down going the wrong way. That DJ Campbell who ran him down, the safety, nicely done by Campbell. Mike Myers not able to get going up the field at all. And Billy Ferris 0 for 5. He is a fifth-year senior, but getting his first chance to play. Did not play much at all. Coming into this year, he played in 9 games. Did not start a single game. So a start this year on opening day against CU was the first time he started since high school.
And he's been pretty accurate coming in, almost 70% passing. Very good completion percentage, but today he's having a rough time.
We got to get the ground game going here to slow down this rush. Johnson able to push out, and he's up to around the 19-yard line. Billy Ferris, 4 touchdown passes on the year and 3 interceptions. Has good size, Mike. He's 6'3", 2 1/4. Throws a good deep ball.
Throws a real nice deep ball. Stands tall in the pocket. Knows how to deliver it. Knows how to move around a little bit. Not the most mobile guy, but he can move enough to avoid the rush and to get outside the pocket. But as you say, Greg, very accurate with the ball.
That's the guy they got to get it to, made that catch. That's Corey Sperry, who was an NFL-type body at tight end at 6'6", 250 pounds. Mike, he has a basketball background, which is so helpful to tight end. Here's the counter to Johnson. Bears are not fooled at all by that. Looked like they were going to run it left, but it was coming back right the whole way. And Rulon Davis is having a terrific first quarter.
So far having a great first quarter. Bob Gregory told us yesterday, Rulon Davis is a guy who can rush the passer, can play the position. But this year, he'll play 2-3 downs, and then all of a sudden kind of take one off, miss a down. And he needs to be more consistent with his play. Today, he has been that kind of consistent at that defensive end spot.
Now, forget the Maryland game. That was just they were just not awake for that game at all. It had nothing to do with them flying in so close to game time. They just came out a little flat in that game. And maybe it was the 9 a.m. kickoff Bay Area time. Well, they were down 14-0 in that game and 21-6. They're up 14-0 today. Ferris on third down, throws short. Nice tackle there by Warrell Williams. That's going to be close. Paunga, Zach Paunga, the fullback with the catch in the flat. And he picks up 4. He converts. That's a first down for Colorado State.
Just a classic naked boot. Get the ball fake inside, roll to your right, and that fullback or the guy that you release to the flat is generally always open quickly. It's a nice high percentage pass, a good pass to move the sticks. Good way to get your quarterback into the flow. So a good call by Coach Fairchild.
After an 0 for 5 start, he hits Paunga for a third down converter. There's Ferris. There's time this time. And it's caught by the tight end Sperry, and he's got a first down across the 35-yard line. That is Corey Sperry. His 12th catch on the year. Mike has got a couple of touchdowns.
As you talked about, recruited as a D1 basketball player, extremely athletic. They're likening him to guys like Tony Gonzalez, you know, pretty good football player at a tight end position, former Golden Bear. They say he's very smooth, that he has the skills to be as good as he wants to be.
He's got good feet and quickness. He runs about a 4.6 or a 4.7. That was a 13-yard pickup. There's Johnson trying to get that corner. Follett. Nice coverage there as they don't let him do it. That's the force on the outside there by Darian Hagan. And that's exactly what the Bears were working on, Mike, not allowing him to get outside. Darian Hagan, who did not play the run as well, especially against Maryland, is playing the run extremely well today.
Yeah, you have to have somebody getting upfield pressure. Zach Follett right here. Of course, he's everybody's All-American preseason. But then Hagan doing a nice job of filling in that second piece. The guy coming for that second tackle, because the first hit in and of itself won't do it. You need to have swarm tackling around the football.
Second and 12. Johnson the lone back, Colorado State, a quad formation, a draw to Johnson. Warrell Williams is there. Follett hits him hard.
Follett unloaded. Warrell Williams had Johnson wrapped up, and Zach Follett made himself a human missile. You can see Leeds count right now, 4.5 tackles for loss. Johnson's a big guy, right? Bruising back. Okay, he's wrapped up. Follett just came flying in. Put a lick on him. That's physical football. That's why they wore pads during the bye week.
Now, he's been good since he arrived here in Berkeley, Mike, but he has really taken to this 3-4. Third down and 12 coming up for the Colorado State Rams. Alulu may have jumped off sides here. Flags come in all directions here. It is offsides against Tyson Alulu. Well, that'll make this a 3rd and 7 coming up for Colorado State. Larry Farina,
dead
referee
ball
today.
Offside. Defense. 5-yard penalty. It remains 3rd down.
You can see Colorado State trying to slow down that pass rush by the Bears. They've used the hard count a couple times, and they've got the Bears offsides now three times. One of the things about cranking up that physicality, cranking up the mentality to be a more physical, tougher team on defense, is you get those defensive linemen cranked up at the line of scrimmage. If you want them to go 100%, then you have to be able to accept a few of those offsides penalties. Because if they start to get tentative in that down stance, then you lose that speed, you lose the pursuit, you lose that big pass rush, and the Bears don't want to lose that.
Now Colorado State calls a timeout here. They want to run one more play before the end of the first quarter. They didn't have to call that timeout. They could have waited and snapped the ball on first down at the start of the second quarter. Go beyond the game with highlights, features, and the weekly top 10 on Comcast SportsNet's High School Sports Extra, powered by the Sacramento Bee and Max Preps. You don't want to miss High School Sports Extra every Tuesday night at 7 only on Comcast SportsNet. You and I are going to be in Berkeley High.
Berkeley.
Coming up in a couple of weeks, I think. Not this coming week on Thursday, but the week after that.
Yes.
Jeff Tedford is tapped into Berkeley High, getting Sean and Eddie Young. And he has just turned this whole program around. It's just amazing what he's done here. Six straight winning years, five straight bowl appearances. And he said, we talked about it a bit earlier, how he has given up the play calling duties. And you see him now more involved with the defense and what's going on special teams. He said, when we were on defense, when I was calling plays, all I ever thought about is, what am I going to call on first and 10?
Yeah, looking at that play sheet, he said, you get the tunnel vision. All you think about the night before, the day of the game, the morning of, is what am I going to call? What situations? You're studying all the time. Now he actually gets to be a head coach.
Ferris goes down on a third down and 7. That's a fitting way to end this opening quarter, because Rulon Davis and Tyson Alulu and that Cal Bear front line just dominated the opening quarter. They got the touchdown of their own, forcing an interception. And here's Zach Follett coming off the edge. So the Bears, they've not scored on offense yet, but they're up 14-0. We like this. Basking in the sunshine here in California, up in Berkeley, where it's 14-0 Bears. And Mike pulled out the word right away at the beginning of the broadcast. Bob Gregory used that dreaded four-letter word football player never wants to hear.
Ever.
Soft.
Soft.
They were soft. Take soft. I mean, they came out and they were anything but soft.
They didn't like hearing the word soft in those defensive meetings either. And they're showing it today.
There's Mr. Whipple. There's Sidquan Thompson. Out across the 30, goes backwards. And the Bears will start inside their 30-yard line. We're going to have to show Kevin Riley the playing field here. They have not played in quite a while. They've not run a play in about eight or nine minutes. They ran just 9 plays from scrimmage in that entire first quarter.
Yeah, you got to be over there on the sideline as a quarterback, warming up the arm. Only 9 offensive plays. You score on special teams, then you kick off. You come back, you score on defense, and you kick off. So it's definitely not a ball control game for the Bears, but they are up 14-0.
Of course, last time they had the ball, it was 0-0. They had a special team score on a blocked punt, and now they've got the ball back on offense. And Javid Best well rested. And he picks up 9 yards. Straight ahead goes Javid Best.
Well, again, the Bears, one of our keys was to establish that inside running game. Doing a nice job on first down, gaining positive yardage. You know, you mentioned, Greg, 30% third down conversions for the Bears. If you get positive yards like this, it makes it a whole lot easier to call your second and one play than it is to call your second and 10.
Second and one. Oh, he had 2 big, huge games against Michigan State and obviously against Washington State. And here he goes. And he's across midfield. Javid Best with another rip off of 15 yards. So a 9-yard run, and now a 15-yard run for Javid Best. Finally pulled down by Gerard Thompson, the true freshman, making the start at cornerback.
And a great finish for Javid Best. Javid says, you know, I'm not that big, but Gerard, you're a true freshman, and I'm bigger than you are. I'm going to run over you here. Welcome to college football, Gerard.
Thomas is starting today because of the injury to Brandon Owens, their normal left cornerback, so he starts over on that side. Only 165-pounder, a true freshman. Coach Fairchild said in the perfect world, he'd probably redshirt him this year, but this is not a perfect world. draw. Green, and he runs through a tackle, and he's all the way down to the Colorado State 41-yard line. Mike Pagnotti was able to get him down. You call them lightning, and they certainly have great breakaway speed.
Yeah, they're both so fast. Javon Best, 10-300, was a California State champion in 2007. Shane Vereen had the second lowest 100 time. He was only a 10-4 in the 100 in high school. They never actually ran head-to-head, but both these guys are smoking fast out there.
10-3 and a 10-4 in the 100 meters. We're talking world-class speed. That would get you on the U.S. Olympic team. Second down and three. Here is Vereen. And they're coming off the right side here, and they pick up the first down. But not just the lightning. They obviously have that. They have the breakaway speed. But they're powering straight ahead here. These guys have got a little wiggle in their game, and they also got some power to run through some tackles.
There's always the question, is he a track guy who plays football, or is he a football guy who plays track? These guys are both football guys who play track. We talked yesterday with Jeff Tedford, and he kind of laughed. He said, yeah, you know, Vereen's the slower of the two. And he kind of caught himself and chuckled. He said, you know, if you call it slow.
What a slacker. He runs the 100 meters in 10.4. Riley is audibilizing at the line here. Rotang is left and Calvin right. He's going to run Best off the right side. So did he audibilize to a different run play to the right side, Mike, or was that a dummy audible?
Just an automatic check. You know, in Jeff Tedford's offense, you have checks. If you come up and you see certain set defenses, certain set looks, they had a reduction that time where they were reduced on the short side of the field. I mean, it cleared that outside. You know that you have good blocking lanes. Riley just made sure that he checked that run to the outside. They got that nice free lane. The Bears offense did a nice job on the right side of just compacting everything down to the middle.
Well, one thing about Colorado State and their defensive coordinator, Larry Kerr, has been around for a long, long time in a number of different spots. They like to play the so-called cover two, where the two deep safeties patrol the middle of the field. Riley looks left and comes back right. That's caught by Best for a first down. He's banged out on the 23-yard line. Pushed out there by Nick Oppenier, the other cornerback, to Gerard Thomas on the other side. When Riley comes up to the line of scrimmage, Mike, here he is looking left, coming back to his right.
Nice job with his head coming back and finding a secondary receiver. There's Hrinic. He's the middle linebacker. You have him trying to cover the flat from the middle of the field at linebacker spot, and he's just not a guy that has the speed to run sideline to sideline like that. As an easy pitch and catch for Riley.
Those two safeties are not playing so much cover two. They're sinking down a little bit. Clint Kubiak comes in the box now. They've got to stop the running game here. Best able to jump over the pile, though, and cross the 15-yard line. And they're going to keep those safeties back. You can run straight ahead against them, and that time Kubiak came in the box trying to play 8 men in the box, but they still could not stop the run.
And you nailed it. The Bears are being extremely effective with the running game right now. You have to try to pack the box, put 8 guys in there. And once you have that effective running game going, now you can open up the pass. You can see the Golden Bears in the red zone 16 times this year, 10 touchdowns, 4 field goals, and 1 missed field goal, and of course the interception.
But again, those stats are skewed by the first two games. At Maryland, they did not do well at all inside the red zone. They got to the 10, the 8, and the 4, and came away with just a couple of field goals.
Yeah,
and
just that, could not punch it in.
People talk about not stopping the run. If they would have been able to score some touchdowns there, they would have been in that game at halftime.
Yeah, and that's where the run really counts, is down in the red zone.
And this is the whole theory of this. These are very good numbers for red zone defense. You're going to look at Tommy Hill, who was their rush end here in the so-called cover two, the Tampa two. This is a defense that is built to allow you to drive.
Yeah.
But when you get inside the red zone, you can't get in. You have to be patient against this type of defense. But then when you get down there, you've got to find a way to score. This is a third down and 1. They go into an eye. Lead play to forward. It'll lead Best, who squirts through. First and goal Bears on the 6-yard line.
I think Javon Best right now is hitting the hole as quickly and cleanly as I've seen him do in his career here with Cal. He's explosive. He's decisive. He's finding the hole, and the holes are there. The offensive line doing a nice job. We talked about prior to the game, they switched right and left tackles. Mitchell Schwartz went to left tackle. Chet Teofilo went out to right tackle because they wanted to give Schwartz that quarterback's backside to protect. Right now, Teofilo doing a good job out there, and Best, an excellent job on his reads.
Direct snap to Vereen, and Colorado State is not fooled. It's a fumble. Vereen coughs it up, and the Rams take it back again. Pagnotti with a huge hit on Vereen. It was a direct snap, and the nose guard, Matt Rupp, recovers for Colorado State, and Larry Kerr is pumped up. What a hit that was on Vereen.
absolutely smoked him, and Vereen got turned around, actually had his back towards the goal line, got off center. As a running back, they teach you, keep your shoulders square to the line of scrimmage. As soon as you get turned around, this is exactly what could happen.
Wow.
And Pagnotta just came up and laid the wood to Vereen. You see him, that right hand coming up, helmet right in the back. Great defensive play by Colorado State. Gives him a chance, keeps the Bears out of the end zone, and keeps the score at 14-0.
Welcome back, Halizad. 14-0 over Colorado State. With me right now, we have Emily Silver. She's a silver medalist in the Beijing Olympics in the 400 free relay. So what was your most memorable moment headed to Beijing?
I think my most memorable moment was definitely swimming the time trial that I did 2 days before the competition actually started. I broke my hand the day after I made the Olympic team, and they wanted me to do a time trial in order to make sure that I was going to be able to swim. So I did my time trial 2 days before the meet, and I went the same time that I went Olympic trials, and it was just the most incredible time. So
going to the actual Olympics, you had no idea whether you'd actually get to race.
Yeah, I actually re-qualified for the Olympics at the Olympics, so it was incredible.
Any plans to go back again to the Olympics, maybe try for a gold?
Hopefully, yeah, maybe in the future.
In the meantime, what are you doing here at Cal? You're out of eligibility.
I'm out of eligibility, so right now I'm just working on my studies. I have a year left of school and just focusing on majoring and maybe like traveling after. So
and hoping to become a high school teacher.
Yeah, hopefully. Yeah,
maybe even a swimming coach. I'm sure a lot of future Olympians want you to be their coach, right?
Yeah, so we'll see. I'm looking to be a high school guidance counselor, so we'll see how that goes.
Great, thank you so much. We're gonna head back to you guys up in the booth.
All right, Kim, how exciting. She just got back from Beijing and she can't wait to travel some more. Cal can be pretty proud. Here's Bell taking the right edge, and he's got a first down out across the 20, tackled by Muhammad. There's Kyle Bell with a couple of nice runs back-to-back for 7 yards and 8 yards, Mike. California's got to be very proud of all the Olympic athletes they had on display. They had them out at the end of the first quarter. There must have been a couple of dozen of them.
Yeah, there is quite a few Olympians here at Cal. 17 medals for the current crew at Cal. I mean, a good group of Olympians. Cal's always great in the Olympic sports. Obviously, probably the most notable of the crew, Natalie Coughlin, a great Olympic swimmer.
First down and 10. First and 10 for Colorado State. Ferris, very close. Look at him stand straight up tall in the pocket over the middle to Bell. And he is tackled by Eddie Young, Sean's younger brother by a couple of years. Now they're feeding the ball to Bell. A couple of runs and now a short one over the middle. Here's what we were talking about. This was the end of the first quarter. These are all the current Olympians from Cal that competed in Beijing. Look at the line here.
Terry McKeever, women's swimming coach. Quite a few Olympians here from the university. Obviously, the university very proud of their Olympians, very proud of their athletes and coaches.
I'm just waiting for football to be an Olympic sport. I think that's
yeah, there wouldn't be a whole lot of competition out there for us, Greg.
You could still play. Here's a counter handoff to Bell. They turned that back inside.
I think Canada might be the only country that could field a team that could even play with us.
But they're not so good on fourth down.
They don't even know what fourth down is.
And you would know. You played in the CFL.
Oh, yeah.
That was one of your many leagues.
That's a really big field. It's more of a pasture than a football field.
110 yards right in the end zone.
110 by 60, 20-yard end zones.
The end zone goes forever.
But the goalposts are in the front.
So it's easier to score in the red zone? It's got to be, right?
It's wide open. But there's fewer downs.
I know that.
So back and forth in the red zone, it's tough.
All right. Third down and 3 for Colorado State. What's Ferris doing? That was a strange-looking bubble screen. He's setting up for Mosier, and it's a first down. The footwork wasn't great by Billy Ferris as he went to his left, but he was setting it back for a pivot for a bubble screen to the back, John Mosier, and it worked. They convert another third down, Steve Fairchild does.
Yeah, quarterback trying to influence defense running this way. Probably should have taken another step or two, get everybody to really commit, and then turn around and throw that ball. So he's a little bit quick, again, inexperienced. He's learning play by play at that quarterback position. Coach Fairchild told us yesterday, yeah, you'd really want your guy to have a few more snaps, a few more reps in that position. But Billy Ferris is a no-nonsense guy. He works every day. He's a lunch pail guy and just gets it done out there.
And he's a good-sized quarterback. Here's the inside handoff. They're trying to get Bell. Well, the ball was kept there. He did not hand off to Bell. That's T.J. Borky came in and took the direct snap, I believe. The quarterback came in. We knew we'd have a wrinkle with this guy in some regard. This is T.J. Borky. And it's a read option there, and that end comes crashing down. Cameron Jordan, Mike, so he keeps the football. And I knew that wasn't Ferris running
that's
with
right,
it.
Yeah, definitely wasn't Ferris running with the ball. Borky, talk about a guy that's an all-around athlete. Lettered in five sports in high school down in Florida, Osceola High. And this guy is a football, basketball, baseball, track, and weightlifting.
And that is an Olympic sport. Don't forget. And Borky is a guy we're going to also see. Keep an eye on number 17 today when he comes in their offensive huddle. Zach Follett and the Bears scout on that play. And Eddie Young also. Watch Follett coming in. In his 3-4 alignment, Mike, he's coming in just about every play now.
Well, he's a guy that you try to get free with the way that you line up on defense. You set your defensive scheme. You try to get him to come off the edge. Try to get him a seam to come through because he's your pass rush guy. He's your playmaker. The weak side linebacker is the guy who's going to do the things in this 3-4 defense.
Second down and 11. Look for T.J. Borky to come in later in the game as a wide receiver. Pocket holds. Ferris throws a deep one. Good coverage there by Hagan. He was all over Morton the whole way down the sideline, and now he looks at him a little bit. The very confident young man, Darian Hagan. Now, Morton beat him last year for a big touchdown when they met in early September in Fort Collins. He gave up a couple of scores, Mike, and one was scored by Deion Morton. But this time, Hagan's all over him.
Yeah, good job by Hagan. We didn't see it earlier. He got a little bump as he turned going downfield. But there's a young player, a young corner, who's learning on the job. Just a sophomore out of Los Angeles. Good size out there, but he's been learning. Started that Michigan State game and growing into the position.
And they went at him. And you got Sidquan Thompson on the other side. They're going to go at the new guy. But Hagan was a great player. Crenshaw flagged down, and down goes Ferris. Sidquan Thompson came on a corner blitz that time. And he was involved on the sack. We'll see if it stands. There was a flag right at the snap of the football.
Sid knew you were talking about him. He had to get, you know, his name was up there. He had to make a play.
Illegal formation, offense, six men on the line. The penalties declined, fourth down.
Gotta have seven guys on the line. Six is not enough, and they didn't get that blocked up, Mike. And here comes Sidquan coming on a blitz.
There's your guy that's off the line right there. It's your tackle on the end. Sid coming on the top, giving good fake, giving it a look, and Ferris never saw him, never accounted for him in his protection scheme. As a quarterback, you have to figure out who's coming and account for him either by putting blockers on him or throwing that hot route.
And he loves getting off the field on third down because he gets to go back and sort of turn the punt on fourth down, doesn't he? Sidquan Thompson with the return of 11 yards following a 48-yard punt there by Anthony Hartz. So the Bears leads 14-0. How many touchdowns for Best today? How many do you think Riley's thrown?
Offensively, not a lot.
Not a lot. Special teams and defense. It's always the best place to be, Tightwad Hill. And especially nice today, get a little shade. It is a hot one today in Berkeley, the first Saturday of fall 2008. We mentioned the matchup last year. Remember DeSean Jackson in Fort Collins? That's a nifty end around, Mike, and that's a 73-yard touchdown. Victory across the goal line, DeSean.
Yeah, hold the ball, hold the ball. That time he held on to it the whole time.
Thought he was going to flip it there. Now watch Best on a 64-yard. This is the first touchdown he's ever scored as a Bear.
Yeah, pounding through people and then using that breakaway speed at the end. Have a couple runs like that today without that big finish.
The final score was deceiving. Cal was up 31-14, and Colorado State had a couple of late touchdowns in a 53-second span to make it a three-point game, but Cal controlled that game. Here's Riley. That's a bad pass trying to hit Vereen. It was open on a seam route down the middle there, Mike, in the middle of the cover two hole there, and Riley just bounced that.
And he was entirely out of sync. Watch him in his drop. He just seems awkward. He's looking right, and then he hitches up and steps wrong, and it's one of those things, a quarterback, you try to open your step and you miss and you hit the side of your foot, and you know, he just fell. He was off balance when he tried to throw, and so that's entirely on your quarterback, Riley. He knew where he was going with the ball, but when he stepped back there to throw it, he just missed his plant foot.
The middle linebacker, Jeff Hrinick, number 10, also applied some heat. There's Hrinick, who will drop into coverage in this cover two, but he's coming here on a blitz again. They pick it up over the middle, dropped! It was right there for Cunningham. Larrell Cunningham, the ball was slightly behind him, but a little behind him, and that's a drop on Cunningham.
You still have to be able to adjust to that. Riley picking up the blitz with Cunningham, throwing the hot route, and he just doesn't make the play. You got to catch that ball. You know, you're here, you're getting a scholarship because you can catch the ball as a receiver, throw it to him, give it to, you know, make that catch, get it in your hands. to the Golden Bears. That's the fewest sacks allowed since 2006 around the country. Bears in third place behind Rutgers and Tennessee.
That's why the performance in Maryland 2 weeks ago was so disturbing. They just did not protect. And that's something Jeff Tedford's team always does, is protect the quarterback. They hit Riley again, and he had to throw that away. They came on a blitz that time. They're coming from all angles here, and they heated up Riley on that series.
Michael Sisson and Ricky Brewer just getting in there, bringing the heat. They're two outside linebackers. So double dog, Sisson coming off of this side. You'll see Brewer right up the middle here, bringing the heat on Riley, and smartly throws the ball away. Get it out of bounds. You know, you can come back and get it with the next series, but don't do something stupid and throw it up. Throw it to a fan, throw it out, throw it on the sideline. Do not give the ball away.
Ryan Anger's second punt of the day. Deion Morton, who was very dangerous as a punt returner, is back for Colorado State, already calling for a fair catch, and he'll take it on the Rams 28-yard line. A 39-yard punt by Anger with no return. So Cal on offense has not scored a point. They have fumbled twice. They have now punted twice. They do lead 14-0, but not the way they usually do. This afternoon's game on Comcast Sportsnet is brought to you by Power Bar, a proud sponsor of Cal Athletics. Power Bar, be great. By Hertz Equipment Rentals, exceeding customer expectations. And by Farmers Insurance. To find an agent near you, call 1-800-FARMERS.
Just had a Power Bar up here in the booth. Pretty good. The protein plus.
You didn't share it all, Mike.
I got another one over here. I love these things.
Haven't had time for anything to eat today. First and 10. Let's see if Ferris and the Rams get going. There's Morton in, and he just dives ahead across the 35-yard line. Now the Colorado State Rams are one play or so away from making this a tight game at halftime. It's shocking to me how the Bears have just misfired on offense today.
Yeah, defensively doing a good job, not soft, being physical on defense, but on offense just not finding a way. And part of it's that offensive line, and a lot of it's the passing game, quarterbacks and receiver communication. With all those young receivers out there for the Bears, they're just not on the same page with quarterback Kevin Riley.
Bears have outgained them, but they have lost two fumbles, one by each of their great backs. Johnson, a big hole. This guy runs powerfully with the dreadlocks flowing out of the back of the helmet, and that Rams helmet as well. He looks a little like Steven Jackson, the former Oregon State star, now starring in the NFL for the St. Louis Rams. Not quite the speed, Mike, but he can.
Yeah.
He's tough to bring down.
Not quite the speed, but a good wide base, good balance, big guy. But he's got that full predator looking, working
like
with
it.
The dreadlocks.
I like it. And again, Steve Fairchild was the offensive coordinator with the St. Louis Rams. Was Mike March was there. So this passing game does have the same principles. Shotgun of Fripps left. And one receiver, Ryan Gardner, right. Pocket holds. It is to Ryan Gardner. And he spins out very close to a first down there. Tackled by Johnson. That's Ryan Gardner, who was from Diablo Valley College, went to Rodriguez High School, and they didn't quite get the heat on Ferris this time. The pocket held nicely for him.
Yeah, the pocket's got to form a dish for the quarterback, and that time you see that dish up in front. Ferris was getting harassed early on. Now he's getting some time to throw, but they're also throwing the high percentage, the quick hitting, the timing routes. Get him in a rhythm, get the ball out of his hands, slow down that defensive line by making him run.
They have moved quickly from their own 29-yard line here inside the Bear 40. 3 minutes to play in the half. Ball was deflected again. Well, they're getting a real good push from the front line, whether it's a three-man line or a four-man line. Tyson Alualu is busting on through. Also, Derek Hill, the nose tackle. He may have deflected this one, Mike.
Yeah, Derek Hill doing a good job getting up there. They always teach those big guys, if you can't get to the quarterback, let that play clock tick off in your head. And when you know he's about to pass, get your big mitts up there. See if you can knock that ball down or distract him at least.
They have deflected four of Ferris's passes. They've also sacked him twice. One was deflected and intercepted by Johnson for a run back score here. Second down and 10. Ferris going for the end zone here. Nobody's home. Just throws it away. He was going to Morton. Ferris went down and just threw it away.
He just felt the pressure right away. Wanted to take the shot towards the end zone. End zone. One of those things quarterbacks do. You start to get frustrated. We saw it earlier. He was getting a lot of heat, and he wasn't completing balls. Well, he wants to make the big play. Wants to be the playmaker. He felt that heat. Ruan Davis pushing the pocket and wanted to throw a touchdown. You still have to be smart enough. Check down. When that heat comes, don't force it down the field. Look down to your next receiver. He had a receiver out there in the flat that that was wide open, but he was trying to go for the end zone.
Rulon Davis did not start against Maryland because of a leg injury. He is having a force of a day here. There's the tight end Sperry. Nice open field tackle by Thompson. Free ball. I think the ground caused the fumble here. The Bears have recovered. Was he down? They're giving it to Cam. Looked like the ground caused the fumble, and this obviously will be reviewed upstairs. Saquon Thompson on the hit.
You'll see, I believe Saquon knocks this ball out with his helmet. Good little tight end screen, and again, they try to use him.
And he's down.
They try to use him because he's such a great athlete at that tight end position. Question is whether that ball came out as he sprawled out with the arm. We can't see it there, but it looks like the ground caused it.
I think it is. Now, that was third down, so they would punt here. We'll see if they look at it upstairs, and they are now going to stop. But they have to look. They look at everything in college football.
Yeah.
And I think when they look at that, they will see that the ground caused the fumble. So then it would be fourth down, and Colorado State would punt the football, I assume.
Yeah, he definitely still had control of that ball, had that left hand cupped over the nose, and the ball bounced on the forearm. When he hit the ground, that's when it popped out.
Well, he may just, if they do overturn this, and we're both in agreement they will, I wonder if Fairchild would actually even go for it here. With 2.5 to play, the way his defense is playing.
Try to get some points on the board. I mean, it's close. You want to get some momentum. Going into the locker room at halftime, you don't want to feel like you've been shut out. You want to get that offense moving, make them feel like they're accomplishing something out there.
And let's see.
I think this is our best look right here.
As the ball,
you can see the ball is cupped in that left hand.
Was the ball coming out though as he flipped and before he hit the ground? That angle, he may have been losing it.
He still had control of it. If he has that hand cupped over the nose of it, you'll see the left hand right here, right here.
No, he still got it.
He still got it. That left hand was cupped over the nose of it.
Yeah, that one angle of the ball when his arm went down, it looked like the ball may have been slipping out, but he secured the ball the whole way. I think Larry Farina is going to say. They'll give it back to Colorado State for fourth down, and then for Fairchild, the call would be,
do you go for it?
Right in this part of the field, and near Cal's 39-yard line. With this late in the half, you may need to jumpstart your offense, but you're playing so well on defense, but you got to find a way to score here. Now he's looking at it a long time, which leads me to believe he is going to overturn, and now he's getting the mathematics right on what yard line they would put it on, and we would say it should be on the 36-yard line, and it would be fourth down and 7. From the 36-yard line, so they're going to have to respot the football. So he's in there so long now, it looks like he's going to overturn this. See where he goes down.
That's where the ball hits the ground.
The 36
is
and rolls
right.
Backwards to where it was recovered, and the 39-40. But it looks like they're going over the down and distance. So this is almost assuredly going to be overturned here.
If they're looking at the same angle as we are, which they are, then it should be overturned because he had his hand cupped over the ball. And he had it on his forearm.
Now let's see who Steve Fairchild sends out. Is he going to send out number 86, his punter, Anthony Hartz, or will he send back out his quarterback, number 15 in the offense here?
You know, if you could see space between the ball and the forearm or anything like that, then that ball wouldn't have been under control. But because he had it cupped in, had the ball pressed against his forearm, he still had positive control of it.
Well, this is taking an exceedingly long time. It's pretty obvious that if they could overturn it, it's fourth and 7 on the 36-yard line.
Fourth and 7. Not a lot of plays in the playbook for fourth and 7.
Yeah, the one you use on third and 7, Mike, use that on fourth and 7.
Yeah, it's a little trickier, though. See, you're a thinker, Greg. That's what you do. You think. I'm a quarterback.
Actually,
I'm thinking fourth and 7. Oh, I better complete this one.
I'm an announcer. I'd like to announce a football game here, but they've called the game off. Dave Kataya, who was the supervisor of Pac-10 officials, are here. I can't imagine what they're looking at so long here.
Well, they have to have positive proof that counteracts the decision on the field. So if they don't have that positive proof, they don't have something that they look at and say, absolutely not, the ball's under control.
All right, here's Larry.
After review, the ruling on the field has been changed. It will be Colorado State's ball, fourth down at the 36-yard line.
Well, the fans hate it, but it's the right call.
All right, now let's see what they do. He's talking to the quarterback. He's going to go for it here, Mike, and I think he has to. They just get one play here and get in the end zone here before halftime. The way their defense is playing, they got a chance to win here on the road.
Yeah, and we'll think about this too. Cal's offense has not been where their points have come from. So if you do turn the ball over, they only have 2:30 left to go, and they've got to drive the length of the field and put it in. So Bears have scored on special teams and on defense, but the offense hasn't been the big threat today. So this is kind of a win-win to go for it right now for Colorado State. If they get the first down, they win. If not, their defense, which has played decently, has to hold that Cal offense.
They send two receivers right. Rashawn Greer, who's had a very quiet half, moves up on the line. Here's Corey Sperry, the big tight end, moving in motion. So bunch formation right. And he's waiting too long, and he's going to get sacked. He's just staying in the pocket so long, Mike, just standing completely statuesque and not looking to get out of there at all.
But there's he had nowhere to go with that ball. It's an absolute coverage sack. The Bears doing a nice job of reading the combo right here. These three guys are going to be your problem. And you see the Bears locking it down here, running to linebackers. They have every route covered, and so Ferris has no option. And it's fourth and seven, so you don't want to just throw the ball away and give it up. He's trying to make something happen, but that defensive line too much, just overpowering the offensive line for Colorado State getting home. But you need to give that one to the secondary for Cal.
So they had the overturn, and they lined up with the ball right at the very same spot, just about. And I got to worry about Cal offensively exploding here with that guy, Javid the Jet. Javid Best just rips off 15 more yards. So he's had a lot of runs today where he's gotten 10 or more. The Bears have sputtered on offense. They've lost two fumbles. Best lost the first one, and Shane Vereen lost the second one. Javid Best is up to 70 yards rushing, Mike, on just 9 carries. 2 minutes to go in the half. First and 10 Bears on the Colorado State 43-yard line. It's blocked by Javid Best. They're going deep ball for Sean Young. He had it in his hands in the back of the end zone and could not bring it in. Double coverage, and what a pass that one was by Riley.
Great ball by Riley. Great catch up by Sean Young. Ran right underneath it. Everything was picture perfect, except for the most important part, and that's hauling this ball in. Sean Young has to make that catch right there. Perfect location for that ball. Riley thought he had himself a touchdown, but just another drop, a miscue. That's what Jeff Tedford was talking to us about yesterday. He said, we just keep having miscues. It's one guy, and it's not the same guy every time. It's a different guy making mistakes, and you see Jeff Tedford not very happy with his receiver dropping that ball.
They called a timeout, and you know, Sean Young's story has been well detailed. He is a sixth-year senior coming back for his sixth year because all of the heartache he has had with the injuries throughout the year. And Coach Tedford said, I did not save a scholarship for him. I didn't know what kind of player he was going to be. I mean, he's 23 years of age. He's going to be 24 before the year is over. But he did make it. They had one scholarship left. They gave it to Sean, but they are just very inexperienced despite the fact that he's a 23, just so inexperienced in the wide receiving core. Next week on Thursday Night Football, Casa Roble and Oak Ridge will battle in the game featuring a couple of Sacramento area powers. Thursday Night Football on Comcast SportsNet. Nobody does high school football better than Mike Pulowski.
How about that?
Are you going to be there?
Coming out to the El Dorado foothills.
You just love this game, don't you?
I do. Football.
Thursday.
High school.
Saturday.
College. You can't beat it.
And the first fall Saturday here in Berkeley, is there any other place you'd rather be right now than right here at Memorial Stadium watching this team play in this condition? Javid Best a little wide there by Riley. And the Bears are continuing to struggle offensively. Riley hit his first four today, and although that was a drop, a pass ago by Sean Young, he has misfired on his last five, Mike.
And that is consistency. Young offense not being consistent. Meanwhile, defense have not allowed a gain of more than 40 yards this season. Colorado State pride themselves, and one of the things Coach Fairchild said his team had to do was not allow the big play.
That's the nature of their defense. They do play a lot of cover two, which is designed not to give up big plays. Roddy will roll to his left, pressure throws back across his body, a catch by Cunningham for a Cal Bear first down at the 26-yard line. Lorel Cunningham, the big target at 6'1", gains 18 yards.
Jeff Tedford drew it up for us yesterday, talking about how you beat that two Tampa. they're in two. You run two guys through the middle and try to influence that linebacker, Hrinek. That time Riley had the throw but got flushed from the pocket, was able to maintain his composure, come back and throw the strike.
Riley throwing an outcut there to Ryan Botang, just off his fingertips, with one of the young wide receivers they're trying to get to develop here. He's a redshirt junior. Of course, he won a national championship with the Florida Gators. Runs an outcut, Mike, there. The ball a little bit high. Got his hand on it.
But he also came out of that route flat. And again, you know, you hate to keep harping on the same thing, but having played the position as a quarterback, you expect guys to come out at certain angles. You expect them to get to certain depths. And if they don't do those things they do during practice, then you're thrown off in your timing and your accuracy suffers.
Well, Riley got pressure right in the middle and had to throw it away. And he threw it high and he took a pop. A flag does come down. We'll see if they roughed him here. Savaro Johnson got in. He is from Oakland. They're saying that ball was not pass interference in the secondary. It was uncatchable. I think there was also a flag
trying
for
trying to look for the uncatchable ball. Jake Galusha was back there at that safety spot.
Pass interference. Ooh. Defense number 11. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
John Oppenheer, Nick Oppenheer, was saying it. He made the motion above his helmet that ball's not catchable. It was too high. Clean hit there by Savaro Johnson. Not the flag there. And I agree with him. Although he did cut off his route.
He cut off the route, and that's the big thing. That's close to an uncatchable ball, and that's a judgment call, so you can't review it.
And watching it live, it looked like the ball was never going to be caught. But from that angle, his route to the ball may have been cut off by Oppenheer. So the Bears get a break. But they've been here before, Mike, inside the red zone. First and 10 on the 11-yard line, trying to score an offensive touchdown for the first time this afternoon. Riley for the end zone. Botang, touchdown, Cam. That was a bullet by Riley.
Boy, that felt good. Kevin Riley stepped back, threw the strike. He had the drop pass, took the big shot. He's had guys cutting their angles off, changing angles on him, to be able to just step back and throw and be free and deliver that football. That feels good as a quarterback. That's where you build your confidence. You build your timing with your receivers. Nyan Botang can be a pretty special wide receiver for this California football team. He's a guy that has the tools, played at Florida, transferred back out here from Brooklyn, New York. He can be a special guy, but he has to get on the same page as his quarterback. And right there, they were dead on spot. Just a quick slant route. Riley doing a good job using his head, looking to the field. Call it a skinny post, call it a slant. It's just one-on-one. Beat your man, give him an outside move, and cross his face. Give your quarterback a target. And that time they were dead on the same page.
And just let his size do his thing, Mike. He's 6'2". Oppenheer is just 5'10". Yeah. So once he crossed him and got inside on the slant, all he had to do was catch the football.
Huge mismatch out there for that man. Nyan Botang, an interesting story, actually. Spent the first six years of his life in Ghana. Ended up in Brooklyn, New York. Lincoln High School. And how about the nickname for that high school? How about the Rail Splitters?
The Rail Splitters?
The Rail Splitters.
Abraham Lincoln Rail Splitters. Not the Emancipators, huh?
Not the Emancipators. It was the Rail Splitters. Speaks three different languages. And one of them is Twi. I'd never heard of that language before that. Spoken by 6 million people in Ghana. At least that's what the press guide says.
You are well prepared today. Here's David Seawright, Mike, with a kickoff. Now, Botang had a little trouble off the field while he was at Florida and wound up leaving the Gator program to win an NCAA championship there. It's going to stay in bounds, and it will not. Seawright kicks it out of bounds, so Colorado State will take over on their 40-yard line. They've had a problem with kickoffs this year. Giorgio Tavecchio was kicking off to begin the year, but a little light on his depth, so they went to Seawright, and he kicks off out of bounds. Coming up at halftime, Cal volleyball coach Rich Feller will be in conversation with Kim. I'm going to talk to Sandy Barber. We're not going to mention the tree sitters anymore.
Wow, though. That should be we're a fun conversation this time, huh?
We're going to talk about actually building the new facilities here, not just for the football team, but for all of the Cal athletics program, something they are in dire need of. There's Ferris over the middle, and a catch by Gardner, and a great open field tackle by Saquon Thompson, who was just a terrific tackler and a great overall player.
And that Cal defensive rush is forcing Ferris to drop his eyes, come down to the check down receiver. And that's exactly what you want this time. You're only rushing three guys. If they can bring heat, that helps you out. It lets you drop seven guys, eight guys back into coverage.
And they brought heat all day. They do get it to Johnson, the back out of the backfield, but Saquon Thompson is there to wrap him up. Remember the opener a couple of years ago when Saquon had a play and he missed those two tackles against Tennessee and they went for scores, and this guy, he can't tackle. Well, has anything been further from the truth?
Oh, he's a great tackler.
Tremendous tackler.
He was just trying to make that huge rookie play. You know, he was going to get the pick six, the interception for the touchdown. Instead of playing solid defense, ensuring the tackle as you defend the pass, he was going for the interception on the first one. And then the second one, he just flat whiffed. I mean, missed it entirely. So he's done a lot of growing up since then and has become just a defensive performer for the Bears.
Well, you got to wonder, Mike, he's not a real big guy, 5'9", but he has the ability. I wonder if he'd have a chance to play on Sundays. Here he is with his interception. He had one, two against Washington State. And he took back one 90 yards from his own 5-yard line all the way down to the other 5-yard line. He's off to a great start with three interceptions already in 3.5 games.
Yeah, and that was just a gift up in the Palouse. Talking to Bob Gregory, he just said that Saquon conceptually understands the game. He has a great mental awareness, and he doesn't talk. He's not a guy that goes out there and talks trash. And I was shocked by that
because
I haven't met too many corners who don't talk trash. That's just what they do by nature. But Sid's a quiet guy that lets his game do the talking for him. And at the end, Gregory tells us, I love this guy. And you almost never hear coaches gush about a player like that.
Now, Colorado State, known for their deep passing, they got to let it fly here with just 14 seconds to play in the half. Rulon Davis putting more heat on. Ferris Lowe, is that ball caught? No, it bounced. Incomplete, trying to hit Gardner, who's become more of a go-to guy today than we thought. But again, Rulon Davis coming around the edge, Mike. If I had to pick one guy for the best player on the field in the first half, I think I'd pick number 94.
Absolutely. Rulon is just bringing it. He's coming up here. You see him bringing heat off the edge, just terrorizing the quarterback, terrorizing Ferris, making him move, makes you uncomfortable in the pocket.
8 seconds to go in the half. Cal has scored a touchdown on special teams, on defense, and at last they got one on offense. They move early. Now Cameron Jordan also moved. We'll see how they call this. This could be on either way. Cameron Jordan may have jumped across and forced the false start there. We'll see.
Dead ball, false start.
Yep.
Number 75 offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains second down.
I think the ruling was that Jordan just flinched.
Did not cross though.
Yeah, where Stratton, he got a lot of depth in his kick slide on that first three steps. So
Dane Stratton, who was playing at the tackle spot. There's Jordan.
Just a little flinch here, but you can't kick step like this as a tackle and get away with it. We're definitely going to pick that one up.
Stratton may have moved a little earlier in any event. 8 seconds to go in the half. And they're going to draw Johnson here. He's going to take it all the way. And he's not going to make it. 1 second to go. And they get the timeout before the end of the half. Now the half is over. And Colorado State will try to get that timeout before the half. The Bears are running off the field. At the end of the half here, we went down with a second to go. The Rams want one more play from the Cal 41-yard line. Hold on, boys. We may have one more play here. That's smart, though. Run back in. Make him close
up. Yeah, exactly. Sell it. Sell it. Get off the field. Get off the field.
He went down with a second to go, so they would have had to have been granted that timeout almost immediately.
Had to be immediate. Had to call it immediate. You see Coach Fairchild, he's asking for 2 seconds on the clock.
It doesn't much matter if you have two or one, Coach.
At this point, just take the one. Just get something.
We'll get one more snap if you get one.
Colorado State, their third and final timeout of the half. It's a 30-second timeout.
So yeah, they get one more play.
Knowing that you're running a draw, too, as a head coach and as a quarterback, you have to be smart about it and tell that official. You go back and tell the referee, hey, I'm going to call a timeout as soon as this thing hits the ground. So those officials have to be looking for it afterward. Coach Fairchild, a former quarterback himself, played quarterback for the Rams at Colorado State.
He was a good one. He was a really good left-handed quarterback, a second-team all-conference quarterback at Colorado State, and a terrific offensive coordinator. He mentioned his time with the St. Louis Rams. He also was the offensive coordinator of the Buffalo Bills.
You mentioned he was second-team all-conference. You know who the guy who was the first-team all-conference?
I do not know that.
Jim McMahon.
Never heard of him.
Yes.
From BYU?
A little nobody out of BYU, yeah.
Funky QB. Right, they got to go end zone here, right? Trips right. Gardner left. He's got to step up and fling it. And they got a guy open, but he overshot Perry. Perry was open, but the ball went to Saquon Thompson, and it's batted away by the Bears. And they will end it. So their defense, anything but soft
anything
in that
but
first
soft.
Half.
Man, they were bringing it. The Bears were bringing heat on that defensive front. And especially, you pointed out, Ruan Davis has brought his game to the next level. Just a simple Hail Mary. You know, the guys in the white shirts are supposed to run down or turn around and look up for the ball. Turned out there were three blue jerseys back there playing center field.
Sean Kutus, who's playing at nickelback today, Mike, got back in the end zone and batted that ball away. So you know when they put on the pads in the bye week, they wanted to be physical. And Kim, they were very physical in that first half.
Yeah, I'm here with Coach Tedford. So three touchdowns, the first one special team, second one defensive. And so what are we looking like? I mean, inconsistencies in the offense. Was that a redemption with that final touchdown there?
Well, it was nice to get one, but we have to play better. We fumbled the ball twice, which you can't do. You know, they drove the ball once really well and then fumbled down here. So you can't turn the football over. We need to get more consistent in the second half.
So what adjustments do you plan to make in the second half?
Hang on to the football. Yeah.
Thanks so much, Coach Tedford.
All right, Kim, thank you. Yeah, the band is back in Berkeley as the Bears are back for the first time since Labor Day weekend. And they've got one in all areas, defense, special teams, and offense. 21-0 Cal at halftime. This afternoon's college football game on Comcast Sportsnet is brought to you by Power Bar, a proud sponsor of Cal Athletics. Power Bar, be great. By Hertz Equipment Rentals, exceeding customer expectations. And by Farmers Insurance, to find an agent near you, call 1-800-FARMERS. That's why you're great, Harold, all the Power Bars.
That's right.
The greater than great Mike Pawlowski with the merely average Greg Pop up in the booth and the very interesting Kim at McNichols downstairs. Kim, I know you talked to the Colorado State people. What did they have to say?
I did. Coach Fairchild actually declined an interview. You can imagine why he's quite busy being as far behind as he is. But I did talk to someone down here who said basically the game is winnable. They just have to play it. As simple as that. They just have to play it to win it.
Well, they got to play it. And they got to get him going a little bit. He struggled a little bit, not all on him, but Billy Ferris threw for just 64 yards, Mike. Now, he completed 10 passes. This is an offense that is geared to go deep down the field, all those 18-yard dig routes and the big stuff down the field. I mean, they're only getting 6.5 yards of completion.
Yeah, they want to hit the strikes. They want to hit the seams. They want to hit the digs like you were talking about. They want to hit those inside slant posts. So they're not getting it done because that Golden Bear defense is rushing the passer and bringing it upfield, getting Billy Ferris uncomfortable in the pocket. It's the big guys bringing it off the edge. They're making big tackles, playing that force that we talked about, stringing that ball to the sideline, playing assignments, which is one of the things they worked on by being in pads during the bye week. Brett Johnson getting the easy gift right there because Browner getting pressure inside, Warrell Williams coming up and making hits. Defense doing an excellent job for the Bears right now, being aggressive and not being soft.
You said it again.
I said it again. They're not being soft now.
Cal being football brought physical. To you in part by Charmin. Coach Gregory dropped the soft word on us yesterday. I said, you want me to use that on the air? You don't call football players soft. He said, yes. So you know he called his team soft during the practice. And there were the times they were, but they've been rock hard today. Good kickoff return here by Colorado State. They're out to their 30-yard line of the 20-yard kickoff return. So if they're going to get back into this game led by the fifth-year senior quarterback Billy Ferris, Mike, they're going to have to get it going right away in this opening series.
They have to really be balanced. Steve Fairchild said he wanted to be balanced. That's the biggest key on offense. And right now with the pass rush coming, they're going to either have to hit the quick slants, the quick stuff, or they're going to have to run the ball effectively at that pass rush, find the seams, and they haven't done either with real acumen so far today.
Start in an I formation. They're going to run straight ahead with Kyle Bell. He finds a seam and he crosses the 35. Bell's done a decent job when they've given him the football today. 7 carries for 22 yards. Gartrell Johnson has also rushed for 51 yards. Another good tackle there by Darian Hagan.
Just getting Brett Johnson's hand unhooked from Kyle Bell's helmet here. This is a pretty dead giveaway that you've got a face mask when your hand gets hooked up in the other guy's helmet.
That's behind, though, Mike. That's all right.
You're not supposed to grab the headgear in any way.
He rammed him.
Hooked him with the horns.
No evidence that I can see. They jumped off sides again. Moving on the line, they stopped that sweep there. Anthony Felder, the underrated inside linebacker, got inside to make the tackle, but we got a pre-snap penalty here, and we'll see which side it's on. Larry Farina is our lead referee today, talking to the linesman and the umpire and the head linesman. It's obviously on Colorado
State. Illegal formation, offense, six men on the line.
That's twice.
Third down.
You got guys right here. You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 guys on the line of scrimmage. There needs to be another receiver off the outside here that's on the line of scrimmage. Colorado State did not have him in there. He was obviously off the ball. A miscue by a receiver in a new offense.
That's sloppy on a running play.
Yeah, we talked to Coach Peterson, offensive coordinator for Colorado State, and he said, look, we were still putting in new offense in the 15th practice of spring ball. We're still putting in new offense all the time. So they're trying to get used to it with a new coaching staff.
38 for Ferris. Got hit, and he does go down again. That is the fourth time the Bears have sacked him.
Now, change of jersey numbers. Keith Browner was wearing 57 in the first half. Coming back out wearing 47 here in the second half. Does a nice job running over the offensive guard, getting pressure, staying athletic, and making a tackle.
So you're sure that's Keith Browner?
I'm sure that's Keith Browner. I talked to John Sunsberry, SID for Cal
here.
It's
not Ross Browner.
It's none of those Browners.
And there's some good Browners.
Some good Browners, some good athletic players.
Saquon Thompson gets down the corner. Couple of blocks and he should go. There's one. He's gone. 73-yard touchdown for Saquon. They've got two on teams today.
Great run back by Saquon. Excellent blocking out in front. But how about Cal's special teams output for points? Better than the offense so far today. And a couple times we were waiting for one of those punts to pop. Sid just had one tackle to go, one guy to go. This time the Bears block it up just right and spring the corner. And talk about how much fun that is for a defensive player returning punts like that. Sid, a real quiet guy, getting that punt return. His teammates are loving that.
All right, so now we got special teams 2, defense 1, offense 1. We got a game within the game. Which segment of this Cal Bear team is going to score the most touchdowns today? They had a blocked punt taken back, and look at this blocking. Once he gets the wall on the outside, Saquon is gone. 73-yard punt return, 28-0, California.
You see a place that's alive with purpose and passion. You see a place inspired by a long tradition of untraditional excellence. You see a place built by the people, for the people of California, the nation, and the world. What do you see? You see Berkeley.
Well, Pete Alomar saying, we got two. Coach Signetti, you got one.
Yeah.
Coach Gregory, you got one.
Pete's special teams guy is giving him a little job security out here with the Bears. That's a happy man. Saquon Thompson getting a big return for the touchdown. Pete Alomar, obviously a big fan of Saquon's. And like we said, Coach Gregory,
our
defense told us, hey, I love this guy, Saquon. So they just loved seeing him return that punt. Getting a little sugar for all that great play out there at corner.
Frank Signetti Jr., the offensive coordinator, and the new play caller is upstairs in the coaching booth. Very short kickoff by Seawright, Mike Myers, the international man of mystery, out across the 25-yard line and drop. You want to see that punt return one more time? And not just Saquon Thompson and his running. Look at the blocking, Mike. He gets downfield to give him the last 50 yards.
Returner has to make one guy miss. There it is. He breaks a tackle. Now the Bears are all out in front, forming that wall, allowing him to get to the sideline.
Boom.
And then a very smart cutback by Saquon. Cut back across the field and use your speed. You're a corner. You're supposed to be faster than anybody else out there.
Now, how fun is that when they roll that in film study and they go, Darian Hagan gets a block. They must just go wild.
Oh, and they run it back and forth. The guys are up out of their seat doing that. Oh, looking at it the whole time.
Well, their defense is breathing fire today. On four touchdowns, Fairchild tries to get his backs going. They're having a very hard time throwing the ball. Again, in respect to Colorado State, they, much like Cal, is a whole new wide receiving core. They lost their top four wide receivers from last year, so you can see with this new quarterback. Now, they are going to bring in T.J. Borky here, number 17.
He is.
The great athlete. So what is Borky up to? He's going to go out wide right and match up with Sean Conte. Let's see if they try to get down. Chris Conte, pardon me. See if they try to go vertical with him. Spear, the tight end, goes tight right. And they're going to run it again. And they've got some success on the ground, Mike, but they're down 28-0 here.
You've got a lot of half left to play, though. I mean, you've got 27 minutes left to play in the game. You don't have to panic, but you do have to be a little bit quicker.
You're reaching for the button.
Yeah, you're thinking about it. You're making sure you have the key and you're checking the glass.
Another lineman. They have had a little problem with guys getting dinged up on the offensive line. That strong side guard, Adrian Martinez from San Clemente down south, a third year starter who was down, a very physical lineman, one of their better linemen on their front five, gets up slowly. He's coming off the field the way he's walking, huh?
You never like to see those big guys holding down around the ankles looking like that. There's so many bodies that pile around them. I mean, they're in there blocking people, and anybody gets knocked over lands on their legs. Most of them wear those big knee braces, but it's hard to protect the ankles when they're in those piles. And sometimes they just get them tweaked up when they're inside. They can walk it off. You know, ankles, a lot of the time, you can walk it off during the game and come back out and still play. So hopefully that's just a minor injury, just a little nick.
Third down and eight for Colorado State. They converted on 3 of 11 previously, a bunch formation right. And Greer, who's very quiet left, another pre-snap penalty here. And a lot of those on both sides today.
You know, the thing about it for Cal is they've been able to do it.
Penalty.
Just keeping seven guys in the box. They only have seven inside, but they're bringing the rush. Here's the guy that's going to move for you. They only have seven guys in that box. We talk about that eight-man box all the time, trying to shut down the run. The Bears able to keep four back in coverage. That helps in that passing game, and you can drop people underneath in zones.
There's Cole Pemberton, the weak side tackle, trying to block Follett. They're going to draw here on third and long, and they're going to have to punt the football away. Well, this is the last non-conference game the Bears are going to play. Next week, they're going to be home for Arizona State to begin Pac-10 conference play, Mike. We know that they weren't a great defensive team last year. Now, obviously, Colorado State is not a great power this year. But, I mean, this defense looks a lot better. When we get into conference play,
yes.
What kind of defense is Bob Gregory going to have this year?
Well, defense looks good, and they have turned up the physicality this week. They are much tougher this week than they were facing Maryland.
They hit it again.
I think the special teams are obviously going to be great going into conference.
Look at Thompson just hit it straight ahead. No wiggle that time. Great blocking. He hit a hole right away, Mike. 34 yards straight ahead. So Saquon Thompson has been special today. Here's a block up the middle. They actually block it right into the personal protector. Nabufi picks it up. He scored two touchdowns this year on teams on block punts. And you gotta love this one, the Quan.
Zip, showing the wheels on the outside. He said, Jonathan, who? I can break a tackle too. And then he turns it up.
Don't get crazy now. I'm going to see him do the 100 meters in 10-3. Where is Javid Best? Here he is behind Tofoʻu on the lead play. Well, Tofoʻu just didn't even block anybody. He was so much out in front, just leading it up there. You don't talk enough about Tofoʻu, the elite blocking fullback, who was a tremendous player at St. Francis High School in San Carlos. So he was a running back in high school, Mike, one of the great West Catholic Athletic League players of all time. And he has taken this lead blocking role.
Oh, he is an absolute bruiser out front there. And he's like a heat-seeking missile, too. He's not a guy that misses his block very often. He at least gets a piece of the man he's aiming for. And that's key for a fullback. You've got to send him in there. He's got to hit the man that he's supposed to hit and let your running back make a cutoff.
He's 253 pounds. Here he is, Tofoʻu, the lead blocking fullback. Hoping Best get that edge, but he is spilled that time by up and here the cornerback, who's a tough guy, looks very unassuming.
And that's never a good sign. When you see the tackling player, the opposing player, stand up and call the trainers over, that's never a good sign.
Is it his arm or his leg?
It's his arm.
Is it his elbow or his shoulder? He landed hard. Oppenheimer kept force on that side and spilled Javid Best, and a hush has fallen over Strawberry Canyon.
That is one man that the Bears absolutely do not want to lose. Oppenheimer, just a nice job.
He hyperextended
his elbow. It going down.
Wow. It's not supposed to bend that direction.
No.
He's trying to brace his fall.
And Oppenheimer doing a nice job at an open field tackle.
Ouch.
But the elbow is not supposed to go that way.
Wow. This is a tough sport. He's a tough guy. He is up. He will walk off the field. Let's see how that elbow is. All right, second and seven, Kale. Best has left the field, obviously, with the elbow injury. And Vereen, tackled by Tommy Hill, has dropped on the 24-yard line. He is completely surrounded by the entire Kale medical staff as we get a look at Javid Best and what happened to him. He's had a great day today, 85 yards rushing, 27 receiving, at a 46-yard kickoff return, Mike, so 158 total yards. But he's lost a fumble, and now he may be lost for at least the remainder of this game after hyperextending that elbow.
At least hyperextending it. That's a painful injury. One of the things is, if you didn't tear anything, that it's one of those injuries that you can come back from pretty quickly. Good medical staff here with Dr. Bob Epley over working on him right now. I don't think we'll see him again in this game, but the question is, with conference coming up, how quickly does he get back?
Well, we'll have to see. It looked like the way it was hyperextended like that, he probably dislocated the elbow. But you can brace that up and play. Some positions it's more difficult than others. That was a great blitz pickup, by the way, by Shane Vereen and the blitzing safety Pagnotta, but they misfired on third down. So David Seawright will try a 41-yard field goal. He's 4 of 5 on the year. The one missed when he hit the upright from 25 at College Park a couple of weeks ago. Nate Longshore is the holder, and that ball is blocked. Just make sure it does not get run back very far. And they'll turn it. Still live. This is still a live play. And Ricky Brewer, that outside linebacker, 56, has some tremendous speed. So they block it again.
And that was either Hrinek or it was Tommy Hill. They were both coming through on the pressure. Both got their hands up, were right there to block that ball.
Ricky Brewer, the weak side backer, wound up with it, Mike.
Coming from right here, you're going to see the pressure coming up.
It looks like Tommy Hill.
Tommy Hill, I believe, got up and got that ball.
91.
Yeah,
right
big
there.
Number 91.
No, actually, it was 45 behind him. Matt Rupp, the nose guard. That's a big nose guard at 6'3". He blocked it.
Tommy Hill
was there. Well, the Rams get a little something back on special teams. Now let's see if they can do anything in this passing attack. Bears blitz Felder up the gut. Bears got away from it. Wide open. Greer finally comes up with a catch. Rashawn Greer, who coming into the game by far their number one receiver, Mike, with 22 receptions on the year. That's a 23-yard gainer there for Greer, his very first catch of the afternoon.
And the deep crossers, we talked about it earlier, that Mike March-style, St. Louis Rams-style offense, the deep crosser, a huge part of it. If you don't have time to throw it, then you can't have it in your system. Ferris using his feet, buying himself some time, able to deliver that ball down the field. If they start hitting that deep crosser, it opens up other routes for him.
That's the biggest play of the game for the Rams, 23 yards. Ferris, a deep seven-step drop. And he throws the out cut, and it is dropped out there by Morton as we check in with Kim McNicholas on an update on Javid Best. Kim, do you have one? Thank you.
Yeah, not really too good of a sign. They actually just took him back to the locker room to get him checked out with a physician, but really nothing new at this point. They don't know exactly what's wrong, and so they're going to check him out. And as soon as I know more, I'll let you know.
All right, Kim, thank you.
Well, I can tell you what's wrong. The elbow isn't supposed to bend that way. Obviously, I don't think we'll see Javid for the rest of this game. The Bears have this. They have a nice lead right now, barring Colorado State with a big comeback. They're not gonna risk Javid Best before conference.
The only question is, where will he be at 12:30 next Saturday when Arizona State comes here? Will he be able to play? Inside handoff on that read option, and they go straight ahead with Kyle Bell. Well, he is a man who is slight of build, Javid Best. He is 5'10", 193 pounds. He had that hip injury suffered against USC last year, Mike, and had to miss the remainder of the year. And there was great concern about the nature of that injury with the blood flow. Hips can be. I saw Bo Jackson ended his brilliant career prematurely. He took that shot last week and, or 2 weeks ago in the last game in College Park, and he had the bruised sternum. And now today, just getting spilled low trying to brace his fall. He dislocates an elbow. Third down and six for the Rams. It is Borky who was in. He'll keep it on the read option and Follett's all ready for him. That's a great player there, yes. 56, Zach Follett. Anytime the Bears need a big play on defense, he's normally involved.
And Follett said, no, you're not fooling me. You're not tricking me with that one. Just coming up the outside, you're going to see him right here. Stay at home. Run your assignment. So many times that play fake is designed to pull those linebackers inside and give Borky, who's a great athlete, the option to run outside. Follett stayed home, showed that he was a smart linebacker as well as a gifted linebacker in terms of physical tools, but smart too, and made a nice tackle.
T.J. Borky actually in a Superstars competition this past spring won it at a 360-degree slam dunk. He is a tremendous athlete. Hope you're enjoying college football on this Saturday. Next Saturday, Nevada football returns to Comcast Sportsnet as the Wolfpack's high-powered offense travels to Idaho to take on the Vandals. Nevada against Idaho. That'll be next Saturday at 2 o'clock only on Comcast Sportsnet. They have not done much offensively. Billy Ferris and the Colorado State Rams, who scored 17 opening at night against the Colorado Buffaloes, their big rival game. Nate Longshore is now in the game at quarterback, and he hands off to Vereen. So Nate Longshore, the veteran, the senior, takes over here with still half of the third quarter yet to play, Mike.
Yeah, and Nate, a guy, I mean, here at Cal has had a great career leading up to this year. Over 3,000 yards passing in 2006, 24 touchdowns, 2,500 yards passing last year, even in spite of the high ankle sprain. And Jeff Tedford likes Nate, likes him as a player, likes him as a team guy. I'm sure wants to give him some reps to keep him in the game mentally, but also give him a little sugar because he was very professional when they decided to put Kevin Riley in there as a starter.
Tommy Hill jumped off sides, but he jumped back on sides. Cameron Mora, a tight end tackled by Michael Sisson right away. Now, Nate Longshore in a designed part of the game opening night here on Labor Day weekend against Michigan State came into the game to play. Didn't go so well with a couple of picks. Then in the big blowout win the next week against Washington State, Mike, and you were there for the game. He did come in and play a lot in the second half.
Looked very good ball control, passing, underneath stuff. Really got him into a rhythm in the game. And I'm sure coaches, that's what they're thinking about here. Get him into the game, let him run the ball control stuff, let him do the things that make him comfortable out there on the field.
And just keep him sharp because you may need him. Third and four, they roll him out, he throws. Cunningham's got it, and that's a Cal Bear first down as we check in with Kim downstairs.
Yeah, definitely. I just got an update on Javon Best. It is a left elbow injury. They're not sure the extent of the injury at this point. They're further evaluating him, but likely not returning to the game. Also, number 94, Rulon Davis, defensive end. They're evaluating his left foot. He was also injured in play.
Yeah, he didn't play or didn't start the game at College Park 2 weeks ago. Of course, the Bears were off with their bye week last week. And Davis certainly was a force in the first half. He might have been the best player on the field.
Yeah, he was a beast in the first half.
Nate Longshore, the senior quarterback, at a play action to Vereen. Gets hit by Hill. Dropped by Moore at midfield. Now Longshore took a hit from the end. Tommy Hill delivered a strike and another Bear drop, just a flat out drop there by Cameron Mora.
Yeah, I mean, that was a great ball, a little bit tipped down, but that's a strike by Nate Longshore under pressure, delivers it. Colorado State said, by the way, welcome to the pocket. Been putting some heat on Riley today. Now they hit Longshore as well, but Mora, usually a sure-handed guy, a guy who is one of the top receivers here for Cal, who's been one of the top pass catchers, just lost concentration. Stopped thinking about the ball and started thinking about the run. You have to secure the catch first.
It looked like he let the ball get into his body too much and did not catch it with his hands. A rollout and a throw to the fullback to Fo'o. And he's got the catch and out on the 32-yard line. Well, this passing game, you know, obviously we talk about all the wide receivers they lost. DeSean Jackson is doing pretty well in the NFL now. The Hawk, Lavelle Hawkins, has done well with Jeff Fisher and the Tennessee Titans, and also the tight end Craig Stevens was a big part of their passing game last year, Mike.
A guy who was a good pass catcher, consistent guy, not your big downfield threat, but a good pass catcher, a guy who knew how to run routes for the Bears, and they haven't found any consistency in those spots. Mora has been a bright spot for him at tight end, but he just had a drop there. The wide receivers, nobody's on the same page with the quarterbacks right now. They have to find that consistency in the timing.
The rain is tackled shy of the first down. The Bears went empty set that time, and the Rams blitzed. And a hot read went out to the back, Vereen, and he just could not pick up enough. So it's fourth down, and the Bears will punt the football.
Wow, did you play the position too? You nailed it. You got the hot read. You got the hot read on the blitz from the boundary right away. That was good.
Saw it there.
Colorado State bringing 4 weak. Now we got to get to the next level. Bringing 4 weak, trying to take the A gap.
There's Anger with the punt, Mike. He's done well as a redshirt freshman. Brian Anger, good luck from behind as he gets this one up in the air. It'll bounce and take a nice Cal roll, touched by Morton before it goes off. But that's a beauty there with the roll. That's 49 yards, no return and out of bounds. Nicely done by Brian Anger. Boy, the Bears on special teams, event special. A couple of touchdowns there. 28-0, California. To cheer about today, 4 touchdowns scored by the Bears. They've not been home for a while, Cale. It's a Labor Day weekend against Michigan State, and they got 2 in a row at home today here against Colorado State. And again, Pac-10 play begins next Saturday, 12:30 kick here against the Sun Devils. Billy Ferris out to Greer, tackled by Conte, who throws him down.
Kind of bulldogged him out there.
Trying to bring that ram down.
Yeah, it looked like he was doing a little rodeo. Upended him.
Well, Chris Conte, he's a big, tall, physical corner at 6'3", 200 pounds, Mike. And get a chance to play here. He makes a nice tackle. Bears defensively have been stout today in all aspects. Colorado State only 143 yards of offense on 51 plays. That's 2.8 yards of play. That's not going to get it done. Johnson up the middle. And it's Mike Muhammad, the linebacker that met him in the hole and held that run down to a 4-yard gain.
Speaking of bulldogging, how about him trying to hold on to that single leg? Trell Johnson just dragging him downfield. He's got him wrapped up by the knee brace, trying to swing the legs like a kid making a tackle on the playground.
Uh-oh, our boy Borky has checked in here. What are they up to? T.J. Borky, who is listed as their third quarterback. Behind Billy Ferris, the backup quarterback is Clay Kubiak, who, by the way, is the son of Texans head coach and former Bronco and Bronco offensive coordinator Gary Kubiak. And Borky is in here, and he's going to line up as a wide receiver in the right slot. Ferris looks that way, now going to tuck it and run. And he was able to sidestep Muhammad to avoid a big hit. That's not a bad run on first and 10. He picked up about 8.
The byline for Ferris there is good decision, bad ending. To get bumbled, going head first into that turf at the end. But a very good decision coming downfield. You see him look. He's looking for Borky. He wants to throw that out to his fellow quarterback. Can't do it. Gets downfield. And a big tackle down at the end. The big boys laying all over them, sweating on them in the pile. Michael Costanza just making a big tackle.
Steve Fairchild pulls his offensive toy, T.J. Borky, over the sideline now. Great drop by Ferris on 2nd and 2. That's a bad throw. Had Greer open, but he missed him, and it was almost picked there by Darian Hagan.
That ball may have actually been tipped. Guys were there in Ferris's face. And you see him, his feet were definitely off balance. He's trying to kind of backpedal out and get out of the way. Yep. Yeah, just came off funky. He was off balance as he threw and fell out, and his shoulders were outside. The ball just slipped off sideways.
And that was Keith Browner, who was wearing 47 in the second half and had 57.
He lost 10 numbers.
And we mentioned we were kidding about his uncles Joey and Ross were great players. Dad, Keith Browner, was also a guy who played at USC, played in the NFL for about 5 years. What a football family he's from. Johnson up the middle, breaks a tackle and runs for a first down on 3rd down and 2. He picks it up. Now, the running game has been decent for Colorado State, but this passing game, Mike, which averages over 260 yards a game, has been nowhere today. They only have in the air today. They're at 72 yards rushing and less than 100 yards passing.
Yeah, and generally a better completion percentage, usually very efficient through the air, have not been efficient today, missing a lot of passes. It all has to do with the Cal pressure up front, keeping Billy Ferris off balance.
Here's T.J. Borky. And he hands off on the read option. So if he comes in the game and runs that pull option, they're gonna make sure he does not get wide and force the handoff inside. And the Bears are all able to swallow that up.
You know what's really funny is you see Borky, he's got gloves on there. Whenever a quarterback's not playing quarterback, they always go to the two-glove look. I covered kickoffs when I was a freshman here, and I went with the two-glove look. Like, it makes us look any tougher.
Well, those fingers are delicate.
All those defensive guys
valuable.
Look at you and go, you're still a quarterback. Take the gloves off.
You want to break a knuckle or something. I can throw.
I think most of us just didn't want to chip a nail.
Second and 10. Straight drop. Pressure by Follett. Throw and an interception by Hagan. He got the heat. He threw over the middle right to Darian Hagan, who comes up with the INT. But again, it was Zach Follett coming off the edge that forced it.
And we talked about the communication issues between Cal's wide receiver core and their quarterback. They're having the same issues on that Colorado State sideline. Ferris right here expecting his receiver to continue across the middle, and he just didn't get it. Deion out there. Just sat down, and you can't let the defensive player beat you across your face. Zach Follett do a nice job of applying pressure, but you have to cross the guy's face. You cannot let him beat you. Deion Morton needs to be in front of Hagan on that pass as an offensive player, and instead he goes behind. So again, miscommunication. Such a problem for quarterbacks and receivers.
There's Nate Longshore back in for his second series. Hands off to Vereen. The throw again, a great lead blocker. He gets on the second and third levels. I love that lead blocking fullback. Well, you know, we were talking about, obviously, Cal and the growing pains with their young wide receiving core, and very much the same story in Fort Collins. In fact, Coach Fairchild said last night that they were just awful, his wide receivers in the spring. He said, I didn't think we had a player on campus who could play the position.
And used the word awful.
It was hilarious.
They were awful.
But they have gotten better. Greer's actually had a good year, and Morton's been decent, but Greer's been just taken away by Jeff Tedford's defense.
And he said he jumped them hard during spring ball. And Coach Peterson, the offensive coordinator, actually said, we thought we were going to have to go out and recruit transfers.
Second and one. There's a blitz. They're nicely picked up. Flags come down. The Bears held. Longshore's going for the end zone. He throws it away. Overthrew Botan. And this will likely be a hold on the Bears in the interior line. Vereen again, Mike, with a nice blitz pickup. This running back can pick up the blitzers.
It's one thing to play the position to be a running back, to be able to run, to be able to catch. The great running backs, I mean, truly great running backs, can pick up the blitz, know how to make reads in protection. They are a full part of the offense, because if you don't.
Illegal motion, offense, penalties declined. Holding offense, number 72. That penalty is accepted. 10 yards, replay second down.
So Mitchell Schwartz is not playing at left tackle, Mike.
Playing that left tackle spot, he's not used to it. And it just gets an inside rush from Michael Sisson. So trying to protect his quarterback, grabs the jersey. And when that jersey comes a foot away from the body, the officials are pretty much going to get that one.
Mitchell Schwartz, what a story. He's a redshirt freshman. He is starting at left tackle. That's the first time that Coach Tedford here at Cal has ever started a redshirt freshman at left tackle, the quarterback's blind side. That's the most important position on the offensive line. So it's second down and 11 now. Screen set up, a bubble screen. And the Rams are all over Michael Calvin, also a redshirt freshman wide receiver. He's been battling a foot injury or toe injury, Mike, all year, which has kind of held him down. But he looks like he may develop into a player when he gets healthy.
He's a guy that has the tools to be a really good player. Jeff Tedford likes him. You can tell when he talks about him, he says he's really deceptive. He's a big body guy. He's physical. He thinks he's going to be a good player. Get back to what I was talking to you about the running backs. If you aren't a blocker, then they have to pull you out of passing downs. That's a dead giveaway in terms of personnel. And so if you can't block, and you can't be an every down back on a football team.
Last play of the third quarter, possibly. No, it's incomplete over the middle. Trying to hit Cunningham. That was a third down. Longshore may stay out here for fourth down. Now it's fourth down and 7. Now they're going to bring on the punting team. Bring on Brian Anger.
And just no cohesion in that passing game for the Bears right now. No cohesion. There wasn't any cohesion with Riley out there. Same thing out there with Longshore. Whether it was Cunningham not fully crossing or whether it was Longshore just missing on the pass, you have to have a consistency. That's a gimme. It's a pitch and a catch. You have to be able to do it.
Anger trying to pooch it inside the 20-yard line. Maybe the 10-yard line. They haven't covered this. They got a chance. They may have batted that out without going into the end zone. Is it a touchback? Flag comes down, I think, late there.
I think they're saying the player was in the end zone when he batted it. I didn't see who it was that hit it.
Well, it's a touchback. The ball will come out to the 20-yard line.
I believe it was Shea McIntyre, number 42, that hit the ball back out, but they're saying he was in the end zone.
And that's the last play of the third quarter, Mike. Bears get another special teams touchdown from Saquon Thompson, lead 28-0 after. And they are rolling, especially on special teams and on defense for Jeff Tedford's Bears, trying to go to 3-1 before they get into Pac-10 play next weekend. But the big concern, the left elbow injury of Javid Vest. Looked like he may have hyperextended it, that elbow, and maybe dislocated it. First and 10, Colorado State on their own 20-yard line. Here's Bell. And the Rams have made a quarterback change themselves. They have brought in a redshirt freshman quarterback, Clay Kubiak. And he is the son of Gary Kubiak, currently the head coach of the NFL's Houston Texans, a longtime backup to John Elway as a quarterback with the Broncos.
Looks like his dad in there behind the helmet, doesn't he? Actually got to see Gary play when he was with Denver. Played them in a preseason game when I was a rookie in the NFL.
This is his first time playing, Clay Kubiak. So as he gets the calls from Coach Fairchild, he's got to look at that wristband a little closer here. Second down and 7. There's pressure up the middle. Kubiak avoids it. Going deep down the field for Greer. He's got it. Conte will catch him. But that's the biggest play of the day by far for either offense.
Gotta love the young kids getting in there, firing it up. Young Kubiak, quarterback, slides and still throws it down the field. Saw that he had one-on-one coverage. The point both of the coaching staffs made is coaches' kids. Watch Kubiak just slide left here, deliver it down the field. But coaches' kids take it seriously. They understand it. They have the focus. They have the they've seen how important it is to their dads. And both the Kubiak boys, both his brother Clint and Clay, take it very seriously at that quarterback position.
That's a 63-yarder to Rashawn Greer, who was invisible in the first half. He makes a big play. Bell trying to reverse his field, stays play side though, and dives inside the 10-yard line. Clay Kubiak. This is his first time playing Division I college football. He had pressure right up the middle. Mike just slid to his left a little bit, very poised, and threw a strike down the sideline.
Just like you're supposed to do it, the way you draw it up in the quarterback clinics.
He's from Englewood, Colorado. Of course, his dad coaches the Texans. While he was growing up, his dad was a backup to John Elway, played on 3 Super Bowl losing teams, and then he was the offensive coordinator when the Broncos won 2 Super Bowls. Second down. Bell, a stutter run, gets tripped up and didn't get very much there. That is Devin Bishop, the brother of Desmond Bishop, on the tackle for the Bears.
And Bell looking for running room. But a nice job by Bishop on the outside, just corralling him, making a leg tackle, which is hard to do on a big guy, a big man like Bell. Hover around 230 pounds. It's hard to bring them down just with the single leg tackle.
Devin wears that number 10 that his older brother wore. Boy, he was a force in the middle of his defense.
Yeah, good football player.
Third down and 6 for the Rams. Trying to avoid the shutout here. Toss play. That's going to be a fumble throw. A design throw, and it's not going to work. It's intercepted by Cameron Jordan, the big lineman. Well, I'm surprised that Bell went ahead and threw it anyway after he fumbled the pitch, and the pitch was too wide there by Kubiak, and the coach is saying, why do they call it a trick play with a quarterback playing for the first time ever college football?
Yeah, but the young quarterback out there trying to go in and get a score down 28-0. See Kubiak trying to get out, and his left guard just getting down and tangling up his feet.
Shelly Smith. And then once the ball hit the ground, Mike, Bell's
got to
eat
that.
It. Don't throw that.
He's got to tuck. But you know what? They're not put in that position to throw. Sometimes in the game, we talk about all these young players, the miscues that they're having, both sides of receivers, you know, squads. In the game, you get amnesia that's induced through all the adrenaline that's in your system.
Green! Well, he gets on the second level. He may go the whole way. That's a rough tackle there by Pagnotti. He was all over his lid trying to get under the ground. So an interception there by Cameron Jordan. He didn't think he'd have one this year. Here's the run by Vereen.
Just finding a hole. Good job by that Bears offensive line. Opening up that inside seam for Vereen. Good patience back there as a tailback. You know, a guy who's a fast guy. Usually you see him want to get downhill in a hurry, get down there and make a play. He had good patience, waited it out, found that seam, just exploded through it.
Shane Vereen is extremely capable. They both came in together last year and they decided to play best and redshirt Vereen. Long throw, rolling and throwing.
Nope.
Threw it into coverage there. And luckily for Longshore, it lands incomplete. Well, if this best injury is severe, Mike, and it's, well, he may be able to play with an elbow injury.
Just a counteraction. Longshore trying to direct traffic out there. He needs to either find a guy that's open right now or keep running to the sideline. Don't worry about directing traffic. Get out there, find a guy that's open, throw it away, or run to the sideline.
Well, the yardage totals are very even.
Very close, but again, most of the scores for the Bears, special teams and defense.
And yards don't matter in the sport. We talk way too much about yardage.
Yards only matter in contract negotiations. And there aren't going to be any of those here.
So when you go into your senior year and you go to Sandy Barber's office and you say, I threw for 3,000 yards last year as a junior.
It does not matter in college.
What does that get you, a better meal plan?
That matters later on when guys are making money at this game.
But all they talk about in football, yards. It's 28-0.
Yeah.
They've scored two touchdowns on special teams. Now, he's probably very concerned about the offense, to be sure, in the passing game specifically. But if this Javid Best injury is problematic, Green is a very capable runner. Out of Valencia High School, guy at 6,000 rushing and receiving yards in high school, but it certainly will hurt their depth. Slocum will have to come up. There's Vereen in the screen game. He's a good player out to midfield.
And Slocum's a good player, too, at that running back position. But you're right, you're losing your number one guy. Having Vereen there softens it just a little bit because Vereen can do a lot of those things that Javid Best can do. He can catch the screens. He can play that receiver position. He can do all that. He's got a lot of speed. But there's a reason Javid Best was the feature guy. You lose him, and it's a problem going into conference.
And Vereen has breakaway speed. Remember the Michigan State game, and it was still tight late. He busted it for 81 yards to essentially ice the game in the fourth quarter. Nice alley for Vereen to run through. Well blocked, and that's a nice chunk there for a first down out of the 39-yard line. He hits the hole very well. He's not Javid Best fast, but he's plenty fast enough to be a lead guy.
Yeah, he's plenty fast. If you run a 10-400, you're moving. Does a nice job following his blocker there again. Tofo'o out in front blocking for him. Just finding the creases, getting upfield. He's an excellent running back in his own right, but having him and Best as a 1-2 punch is a much more potent attack than Vereen out there as your number one guy with maybe Slocum coming in next. There's a reason Javid Best has been so hyped. It's because he's such a special player. And again, it's not just offense.
Here's Slocum. Slocum takes a carry, Mike, and he gets a bit. If they block like this, it won't matter. Who
would
give it to?
Exactly. You and I could run the ball back there and get over 100 yards.
Well, let's not get crazy.
Well, you could.
But Slocum, as a sophomore, he's made some good runs this year.
He's a good football player. The Bears don't have any bad backs on their staff. That's the thing.
No, they wouldn't be here.
Yeah, they're such good running backs here. Best has set himself apart. Vereen has set himself apart. And now Slocum getting an opportunity to set himself apart and show what he can do. But Best isn't a guy just on offense. Remember, 234.7 all-purpose yards, so return yards, too.
Slocum from Clovis East High School.
Clovis East.
In Fresno, a school you know well.
The double wing offense.
Is that what they ran on Thursday?
Oh, it's double. Actually, they ran an I single wing set. So they're really advancing. They're throwing the ball like seven times a game now. It's crazy. They're airing it out. It's like Air Coryell down there. Coach Tim Murphy. Clovis East Timberwolves. I was talking to Jeff Tedford about it yesterday because he's from down that area. Obviously down in Fresno. Fresno State guy. He knows Clovis East. But you get a couple quarterbacks who like to throw the ball together and talk about that offense. It's kind of get that look and smile, kind of like, yeah, they win a lot of games with it, but I'm glad I didn't play in the offense.
Longshore audibilizing here. And moving his back to Fo'o to an offset eye left. He's going to throw left, and it's caught for a touchdown. Beautifully done. That's a good call there by Nate Longshore. It's Jeremy Ross for the touchdown and the quick slant. He sees something in coverage there.
Yes, very well executed. Again, you pick your numbers. Which side do you have numbers on, and what kind of coverage are you looking for? You're going to have a swing route. Tefo'o comes here. One route coming down inside. That's where Ross is. And you have another route on the outside. So you're working a triangle read with vertical routes, where you have two routes going vertical up the field and one swing. And that linebacker is your pivotal guy. If he jumps the swing route, you're throwing your inside. If he sits on the inside, you can look to your outside and back down to your swing. But it gives you three reads. And it was extremely well read by Longshore there. And he actually used his eyes to move the linebacker.
And Ross read it as well. He ran the slant, got it in there. So the Bears have their second touchdown on offense now. 90-yard drive there, executed beautifully by Nate Longshore. 35-0 Cal. These folks out on Tightwad Hill are not included, but 63,970 actually inside the bowl here at Memorial Stadium in Strawberry Canyon. And the Bears have drawn over 60,000 yet again. 15th time they have done it under Coach Tedford's reign. 26 straight time they've had
and
over 50.
Another kickoff out of bounds.
See right out of bounds. That didn't hit Kim, did it?
Said that to his team that you guys really have to get mentally prepared. You have to visualize all these fans out here. And it's going to be pretty much some of those other circumstances that you guys are going to experience this season. And I have to admit, these guys are a little intimidating.
A lot of shrieking going on over there.
What was that, Kim?
What?
Get some earplugs. They are pumped up. There's Kubiak in at quarterback over the middle to Gardner. Ryan Gardner, who is from the Bay Area again. Welcome for Fairfield, went to Rodriguez High School, then on to Diablo Valley College, where he was a track star. And they're trying to get his athleticism on the football field. And he got dinged up a little bit, needs an equipment adjustment. Good athlete, Mike. 42-inch vertical jump. They've been trying to get some more athleticism, feed him the ball, and get T.J. Borky out there and see if they can make some plays.
They need to develop that receiving core, because right now they've got two guys. They have Morton Greer, but they need to get more options for their quarterbacks.
Second and three. Kubiak, the new quarterback, to Nashur, and that's a nice run there by John Nashur. Runs back their kickoffs. That's a 13-yard run straight ahead. Paul Madsen is the younger brother of Mad Dog Madsen, the former Stanford Cardinal, longtime NBA player. We mentioned Gardner. Javaro Johnson is from Oakland, and Jordan Wood is from Daly City. Also the punter, Anthony Hartz, is from Oakland, went to Bishop O'Dowd High School. So
a lot of Bay Area connections out here.
We got to recruit here.
You have to. It's a football powerhouse.
First and 10 for Clay Kubiak. Nashur trying to get that corner. Conte steps up and trips him up. Nicely done there by Chris Conte. From down south, went to Loyola High School in L.A. And the tackle of Nashur. He's from Miami, Florida. So Colorado State, obviously, they recruit from coast to coast.
Yeah, they are all over the place. They get some guys that transfer in. They get guys that are a lot of family guys, obviously, coming in. They're really strong around Colorado recruiting. But as you said, you have to recruit the hotbeds. California, Texas, Florida. That's where you get your speed. That's where the fast guys are.
This is their last non-conference game as well. They're going to begin their eight-game Mountain West Conference schedule next week. And a tough one against UNLV. Kubiak got it out of there. It's caught by Martin inside the 10. They're going to spin him into the end zone. Conte kept spinning him, and he propels him all the way to the one-yard line.
Wow, what a great play by Kubiak. Stepping up, he did it ugly, but he did it. Stepping up, had a lot of pressure, a lot of heat coming. Cal's D-line closing in on him, but you see, under pressure, kind of a little jump pass there. And delivers a perfect strike to Morton, so real good composure under pressure. And a nice ball.
And it's the way he avoided the rush like he did on the big ball to Green on the sideline. Like the way he's able to move laterally just to get off the heat.
And stay focused downfield. That's hard for a young quarterback to do.
Sure, trying to get in the end zone. Bears still have their first team defenders out there, some of them. So they're trying to get this shutout if they can with 6.5 to play in the game, up 35-0. So Kubiak comes in here, and you know everybody in Fort Collins now is going to say, play him next week play UNLV.
Exactly.
The guy's throwing three passes, but he's an option maybe later in the game if Ferris in the passing game struggles.
Definitely an option. He showed great composure here in this game. Obviously, circumstances changed during the game. But Kubiak's showing a little something, and the upside is he's a young kid. You get him reps, you get him snaps, and you get him experience, and he's going to get better.
And the shotgun, and now he goes under center, and they motion into a tight formation. John Mosher trying to get in. And Bears stack that up, and they may have to throw it in. Third down coming up, third and goal. Kubiak, we mentioned earlier, he has the initial K in front of his last name because his older brother, Clint, plays on defense and a tremendous free safety for the Rams. So Gary Kubiak, the head coach of the Houston for the Colorado State Rams.
And both great additions. Again, the coaches talk about coaches' sons knowing it, getting it, being very coachable, very focused on the game. They've seen their dads around the game. Both the Kubiak boys instrumental in this team. Clint has been a real leader on that defensive side of the ball. See Fairchild throw. He looked at film, and they were just better with him in there. And now Clay's showing that he can play, too.
Keep an eye on that tight end, number 80, Sperry. He's going to block. Well, sure, stumbles, but he will get into the end zone. Touchdown, Colorado State here. They avoid the shutout. John Mosier on the touchdown run. And a great pass down the field. Clay Kubiak, a 36-yard strike, and that gets the Rams in the end zone.
And Mosier, not a bad third option for Colorado State. Actually had a huge kickoff return versus Colorado in their first game of the season. He's got good speed back there, so a third back.
And this is Jason Smith, who was trying the extra point. He's doing it, Mike, with a broken arm.
Yeah, he's got the soft cast on.
He was going to be their kicker and their punter, and he broke his arm. So at last, touchdown, Colorado State. John Mosier powers in to make it 35-7, Cal. A little warm one today. Hope that does not melt on him, but he's proud of his blue and gold Cal Bears. And there's the combination, lightning and lightning. And they both have 7.7 to pop for best and 6.5 for Marine. That'll work.
Almost identical in their numbers. Both these guys, excellent ball carriers that we talked about. 7.7 yards per carry average, 6.5. That'll win some football games, but you got to hold on to it.
Got to hold on to it. And you got to stay healthy. And Javid Best has now played for a while here with a left elbow injury. He normally would run back kickoffs. Slocum is back along with Hogan. And Hogan runs it out across the 40 or close to the 40-yard line. That's the cornerback, Darian Hagan, on the return.
And young guys getting some action on the return teams now. Obviously, you know, I talked about it, Javid Best missing not just on offense, but on special teams too. That's a big loss. You got some holes to fill with him out injured.
Well, Nate Longshore has taken over since mid-third quarter for Kevin Riley. He had decent numbers, actually 6 of 13 for 59. It's more on the not so decent, but not bad. Longshore actually has put up better numbers. He has thrown one touchdown, as did Riley early on. Marine dancing behind the line. He'll pick up a yard or two. And we were talking to Coach Tedford yesterday in his office for a while, Mike, and I asked him with the inexperience at wide receiver, did that factor into your choice at quarterback? Because you may have had a call between a senior and Longshore and a sophomore, Riley, who made just one start all of last year. I mean, you would think you'd want the senior quarterback there to help these young wide receivers along. He said no, that was not the factor. It's the fact that he can make four or five plays a game with his feet, and that's a great advantage to have.
It is a great advantage to have. Your question, though, was a great question, because with young receivers, having a settling factor in there, as a senior quarterback, Nate Longshore, knows the offense inside and out, been working this offense forever, that can settle those guys down. It could help.
Now let's check in with Kim downstairs.
Yeah, Darian Hagan looking for redemption against Colorado State last season. Had a big opportunity to show what he's got, filling in for Saquon Thompson, and it was against CSU, and it was an eye-opener for him. They made some pretty big plays against him, but, you know, he's worked hard since, and at camp he won the starting position. So what do you think, redemption?
Without,
pretty sweet for Darian Hagan, don't you think?
Yeah, he has certainly gotten revenge today. Gave up a couple of late scores last year in a game that was lopsided. But, you know, he was targeted, and he was targeted opening night against Michigan State, and he'll be targeted all year. Down the sideline. And that's a big run after the catch there.
Grant Tucker,
who Coach Tedford said would play a little bit today, says he seems to be catching on. He's a junior college transfer, but a good body at 6'1", 192 pounds.
And showed us a burst of speed right here. A guy you get the ball on a receiver screen. Great shakes for a big guy.
He stepped out right there, didn't he?
And really just got a burst of speed heading down the sideline. Coach Tedford said he's really just starting to get this offense. A late transfer in, was only in fall camp, and so he's really starting to understand the offense recently. But his physical skills will help that receiving crew.
But they're really shuffling wide receivers. Obviously, the game is lopsided. We're getting a look at a lot of people here, but a catch by Tucker, the 10th different Cale Bear to catch a pass today from two different quarterbacks.
And you'd like to have four guys. Okay, these are our four guys. These are who we go with. This is who we know. And I'm comfortable with these guys. And then two more guys to spell them. You know, guys that you can put in, give them a spell. But so that you get on the same page with your quarterback. But when you're just rolling guys through that receiver spot, it's tough on a quarterback to get your sense of timing, your sense of where that guy's going to be and when he's going to make his break.
Second down and nine. We're 2.5 away from the end of the non-conference portion of the schedule. As Slocum gets a big hole, cuts back inside, and he powers down to the 16-yard line. This is a very nice run there by Tracy Slocum here, a sophomore from Clovis East High School. Nice block there by Drew Glover, the wide receiver. The receivers really have to block in this running game. That's how you get all the big plays. And here's Glover.
Nice block up front hitting Clint Kubiak. Again, we talked about Clint being one of those defensive leaders for Colorado State, a big hitter. Good job outside making the big block. Young guys out there making plays.
They got some big wide receivers,
yeah,
don't they?
That's a big man out there at that receiver position.
I mean, compared to the group they had last year, where they're great receivers, but Deshaun Jackson weighed about 160 pounds, didn't even a little guy.
On a rainy game.
LaVelle Hawkins after a shower. And Robert Jordan, I mean, they were smallish receivers. This group they have, they're not nearly as skilled or experienced, but they're way bigger.
Way bigger.
35-7, that's a big lead for Cal. From the Berkeley Hills, today's game on Comcast Sportsnet is brought to you by Power Bar, a proud sponsor of Cal Athletics. Power Bar, be great. By Hertz Equipment Rentals, exceeding customer expectations. And by Farmers Insurance. To find an agent near you, call 1-800-FARMERS. Speaking of agents.
Yes.
I think that's 109 Panoramic Way.
Yes. The former office of Lee Steinberg.
The great Lee Steinberg. Steve Bartkowski was his first client ever. This is going to be a touchdown for Cameron Moore, a walk-in. A long short, nicely run there, Mike. Little roll right, came back and throw left, and Moore was the lonesome end.
And he settled the offense a little bit, hasn't he?
He has. Played well. 41-7.
It's pretty easy when your throws are that wide open to look like you're settled, because the whole defense influences with Nate going rolling out to his right. Cameron Moore just slipping back underneath. That makes it pretty simple. That just needs to be pitch and catch. But, you know, Nate's looked pretty solid, and the offense has really settled down with him in there.
Well, at the very least, he is a tremendous backup to have. But he's made some mistakes this year throwing some picks, but today he's been razor sharp, 9-13 for the first pass and a couple of touchdowns. So with 2 minutes to play in the non-conference portion of the schedule, what do we know about the Cale Bears? Let's start on offense. We know they can run the ball.
They can run the football. We know that Javid Best is up in the air right now.
The thing about Best, obviously Vereen is very skilled.
Very good.
If they lose Best, when we were talking to the Colorado State coaches.
First thing you mentioned.
They were scared to death of the guy.
Yeah.
They said, number four, how do we match up his speed? So you have to game plan. It changes everything. But next Saturday at 12:30, Arizona State will be here. Mike and I will be at Tucson on October the 18th to bring you the game against the Wildcats. So they can run the ball.
They can run the football.
How well, with a young quarterback and a bunch of young wide receivers, very inexperienced, are they going to be able to throw the ball?
Well, that's the problem. And here's the thing. During the season is not when you make your greatest strides at developing timing. It's when you're out there in shoulder or just shorts and tennis shoes in the summer, maybe your shirts are off, and you just run the route again and again and again and get those guys grooved in where it's just automatic memory that when I hit my fifth outside step or when I hit 18 yards, I'm running this route right. And so it's hard during the season, especially when you're rotating guys in. And another wonderful kickoff.
We know they got to stop kicking the ball off out of bounds.
That's one thing that will drive coaches nuts.
The ball will be placed at the 40-yard line.
There's Jordan Kay, who was the kicker a year ago. C. Wright took over as a true freshman. Remember opening night against Michigan State, they tried Giorgio Tavecchio, who I was rooting for, obviously. I love that name. Tavecchio!
Yeah, another Italian guy, huh?
He didn't do as well.
And there, that was the look on Pete Alomar's face. As much success as he's had, you know, blocking the punt and just having a kicker, unforced error, kick the ball out of bounds on a kickoff. That's just brutal.
But beyond that, we know on special teams they're pretty good, especially if Vestas is healthy. I mean, they got a great punt returner, a great kick returner. They block punts. They're really good on teams.
We know this as a team. They're aggressive. They're physical. They get after it when they get out there. There's no lack of effort anywhere throughout the whole facet of the game. The guys are playing hard. Now, are they playing smart? That's the question on offense. Are they playing smart? Are they hitting their depth? Are they finding the open lanes? Are they reading zone man? Are they getting the right reads? Well, they're not doing that on offense right now, not in the passing game. The running game looks good. They're blocking well for it, but quarterback's still taking shots, too. So in conference, they're not going to be able to get away with that. They have to have all three facets of their game, offense, defense, and special teams intact, or else they're going to have problems.
How good can they be on defense? Because you think Jeff Tedford and Kale, you're always forgetting about the running game, but they score. They score a bunch of points, but they've given up a bunch of points.
They have.
Is this going to be a completely different team where they're going to have to win with a little more defense and special teams?
Well, they're clearly going to have to with this team because offense has not put it together. Defense doing a great job of picking them up here today, but over the course of a season, the defense is going to have to be special if they're going to pick them up week in, week out.
Of course, the Bears did play one conference game. In fact, it was the most lopsided conference win in their history as they buried Washington State in the game you saw here on Comcast Sportsnet 66-3. But from this point forward, no more non-conference games, strictly Pac-10 games. And at home, they're going to play Arizona State, as you mentioned, next Saturday. UCLA will be in October the 25th. Oregon will be in November the 1st. And towards the end, Mike, Stanford, November the 22nd and December the 6th, the Washington Huskies are off to a winless start so far for Ty Willingham. They'll be out.
Yeah, and an interesting switch on that one. The Washington game being the last game.
Yeah,
obviously, Stanford. Traditionally, Stanford, the big game, is the last game. But Washington complained because they didn't have a bye week this year. Got that game pushed back into December.
Kubiak, Mosher.
He just finds a way to get the ball out, doesn't he? I like this young quarterback. I like Kubiak. He doesn't look pretty, but he's extremely effective. Short release, extremely accurate passer. He moves his feet, remains a passer. He does all those things that you're looking for in a young quarterback, and he looks like he's been in the pocket, like he's comfortable there.
5 for 6 for 117 yards. Now, as we're heaping praise on both backups today, Kubiak and Longshore, the game changes.
Yeah, it does change.
When you get so far on one side or the other, the defensive changes. A lot like when we saw Cal's passing game come alive in the fourth quarter 2 weekends ago at College Park. I mean, a lot of that was just based on the fact Maryland was playing a different defense.
Yeah, you go against prevent defense, and you're going to look like you're running the run and shoot every week. I mean, you're throwing the ball down the field, you're getting guys open, and it allows you to rack up a lot of yards. That man right there trying to figure out, how do I get on the same page with these wide receivers? And that's going to be the biggest thing. The quicker that they can come together and get on the same page, or if Jeff and Frank Cignetti have to limit their offense to find the things that they are on the same page about until they can expand it and let guys learn on the fly.
Hand off to Mosher. Oral Williams playing down the stretch. Again, they push him forward to give him the first down. They just want to get him to the ground here with less than a minute to play. I haven't talked much about Warrell Williams and what a tremendous player he has been and continues to be for the Bears. This transformation to a 3-4 defense, I think, is just an obvious move because they've got so many good linebackers on this team.
Great linebackers. Not just good, but great linebackers all the way across the board. And Bob Gregory told us yesterday that it's easier to recruit that body style, the linebacker body style, than it is to get that big five technique or three technique defensive tackle, the guy who's a stand-up rush guy who can get it done outside. And so playing that 3-4 makes more sense. The big bodies are tougher to find, You put three down, guys down, and then use your linebackers and move them around. Play games with them.
And it also may help you on special teams. Linebackers are far more athletic guys. Those are the guys you want on special teams. That could be a reason why the Bears are so strong today. What a game they had on special teams. They scored with a blocked punt for the second time this year. The play of the game is that run back by Saquon Thompson, though. Kubiak, get out of bounds before he gets popped, and he does. We are out on the 21-yard line. And since we are under 2 minutes, 1:59 is the magic point you have to hit this year in college football. They will stop the clock as he runs out of bounds. They're running the college game now very much like they run the NFL game as far as the timing of the game.
Yep, trying to speed the game up a little bit, keep continuity.
51 seconds to play. Cal up big, 42-7. They'll go to 3-1 overall. And they'll get ready for Pac-10 play coming up next Saturday. Mosher's played well here. He continues to break tackles. They finally drop him inside the 20-yard line. John Mosher out of Columbus High School in Miami, Florida. He's done a nice job since coming in, spelling Johnson and Bell. They'll rush it up, see if they can get in here. First and goal from the 8-yard line, and they'll spike it there to stop the clock with 41 seconds to play, Mike.
Well, they're trying to get that pride touchdown, that one that says, hey, we kept fighting, we kept going until the end. And take some positives away from this game. I'm with you, too. I like Mosher. I think he's a good back. Runs hard, fights hard. Obviously, he's got two very talented backs in front of him, both in Gartrell Johnson and Kyle Bell. But Mosier's shown up, too. And the coach has said, we got to find a way to get him on the field. This is the kind of guy that makes things happen when he touches the football.
Second and goal from the 8-yard line. Kubiak on a handoff, and the Bears are stout again against the run. And a timeout will be called by Colorado State. Mosher didn't get much there. Third down coming up. Got a yard. Well, good luck to Steve Fairchild and the Rams trying to put this program back. They were 3-9 a year ago, 2-9 in Mountain West Conference play. So congratulations to the Pac-10, Mike. They're finally going to beat the Mountain West.
How about that?
The 5-0 record, the O is got to go.
Yes.
Now they got one. That is rather shocking.
Mountain West looking very strong this year. BYU especially looking extremely strong.
Well, they've got two of those wins.
Well, here's the Golden Bears touchdowns, and you're not going to see a ton of them on offense.
The Boofy's already got two this year.
The Boofy's going to show up in the stat sheet.
He leads the team in scoring.
Brett Johnson coming through. The strike to Boateng. Saquon Thompson.
This is the play.
This is a great one.
Great return right down here.
The long short comes in. He can throw that thin seam.
There's Jeremy Ross on the last one. Kubiak trying to throw his first touchdown pass and
trying to make it happen.
College football overshot with Sean Greer out of North Las Vegas, Nevada. He's a track star as well, 110-meter hurdle guy.
Yeah.
The last play here, fourth down, last chance to get in the end zone with 30 seconds to play.
Kubiak's throwing it. You know he is. He's going to wing it.
He's a Kubiak.
He's going to wing it. Giving that young quarterback some reps, a shot to show what he's got out there. Kubiak has shown very well for himself today.
He's got a bunch formation left. He's got Gardner singled up right. He's going to the single guy. Jump ball. Hit his hands, but incomplete. Good coverage by the Bears there. Conti, and the Bears will take over. So the Bears with 6 touchdowns today. What is that? 3 on offense, 2 on special teams, 1 on defense. Right? So the offense does well.
3 on special teams, right? Punt return, 2 kick blocks.
One kick block, huh? We've lost track.
I've lost track.
No, one punt block.
I was going to get back-to-back defensive kick
block. Three on offense. Yeah. Riley threw
one defense, two special teams. You're right.
Cignetti's saying, I win.
I want it back.
Three,
I want it back.
Two, one. That's quite balanced. But the big concern, obviously, and what you read about in the paper tomorrow, the elbow injury to Jonathan Gass. Just how serious
it's
is gonna
that
going to
be? That's the one that you worry about, obviously, in the rushing attack. Jeff Tedford and Frank Cignetti going back to the drawing board to get their passing attack down. And it's funny, you talk to Jeff, and we saw him at the Washington State game. You know, big win, they were way ahead, and he was still on his guys. And he told us yesterday, it's the little things, the minor details that make a difference. And again, they didn't get the minor details done today on offense either.
What's the headline of the Chronicle tomorrow? Not the best of wins. You like that one? That injury to job at best?
I can never judge headlines.
42-7, you got to take that, as they had three offensive touchdowns, two on special teams, a blocked punt, and a tremendous one was the 73-yard punt return by Saquon Thompson, who was just a tremendous cover corner. He started every game here in California for the Golden Bears. Never hear a peep out of the guy, except when he gets in the end zone to celebrate. That was some punt return. He laid on Colorado State. And 187 yards on punt returns. That's a new Cal record, Mike, including the 73-yarder. He also had a sack on the corner.
A sack coming in. Some quickness here on the punt return. And as you said, Greg, great blocking out in front. Laying down the white shirts. Boom! Big old hits. That'll be fun to watch on film.
This one's
and another big punt return right up the middle. Getting some seams out of that punt return block team.
He had a pretty good game today, huh?
Sid had a nice day.
Quan, and we'll talk to Saquon Thompson coming up as we continue. Kim McNicholas will. All Cal today, 42-7 over Colorado State.